World News Tonight, wanted men. Growing fears that a terrorist team has slipped into the country just in time for New Year's Eve. Did someone pay a smuggler to sneak them in? Security deadline. Airports struggle to screen every bag for bombs. Can they really pull it off? Twin showdowns. North Korea warns the U.S. to back off. Iraq girds itself for war with America. The year of the blockbuster. Hollywood's profits surge on spiders, hobbits, Jedis, and Greek weddings. We'll take a closer look. And a brilliant year. What were the five most intriguing discoveries and innovations of 2002? We'll count them down.
From ABC News World Headquarters in New York, this is World News Tonight with Peter Jennings. Sitting in tonight, Elizabeth Vargas.
Good evening. The year is ending where it began, with enormous tension over possible terrorist attacks. There is so much concern that late today, authorities shut down New York Harbor to all recreational craft. 2,000 law enforcement officials are now working throughout the Northeast, hunting a group of men who may have slipped into the country to carry out terrorist attacks. ABC's Bob Woodruff is in Times Square, where 500,000 people are expected to ring in the new year. Bob, what led authorities to close the harbor?
Well, Elizabeth, what they're calling an uncorroborated threat. ABC News has learned that overnight, in six different locations in Brooklyn and in Queens here in New York, police conducted raids looking for evidence. Sources tell us that these locations in New York have a direct connection with the smuggling ring in Canada, but law enforcement officials say that, as far as they know, the individuals that were questioned deny having any connection or any knowledge of these particular men that are being sought. And just a short while ago, Ray Kelly, the commissioner of police here in New York, confirmed this and told us that so far there have been no arrests.
These are individuals that were spoken to that may have some contact or some information regarding the five or more persons that we're looking for.
Meantime, New York's Port Authority has restricted access to the city's waterfront in both New York and New Jersey. Only emergency vehicles such as ambulances, police, and fire trucks can drive along New York's harbors. More significantly, late this afternoon, the Coast Guard closed down the waterways around New York to all private boats in direct response to a possible threat.
There is an uncorroborated threat to the harbor. What has happened in response to this threat, in an abundance of caution, the captain of the port, the Coast Guard captain of the port, has decided to restrict waterborne traffic of small private craft from the hours of 3:30 into tomorrow morning, 3:30 p.m. into sometime tomorrow, and we support that.
Now tonight, Elizabeth, the city expects at least 500,000 people, maybe even as many as 1 million people to come down here to Times Square. The security is massive. We have choppers overhead. There are snipers on the roofs. Thousands of police officers, at least 900 cops, are undercover mixing with the crowd. And one very interesting thing, the police, all of them here, are carrying around a picture of these five men that they're searching for, just in case they are mixing in this crowd as well. Elizabeth?
All right, Bob, thanks for that live report. We learned today that those five wanted men could belong to a team of 19 men or more. And as Bob alluded to in his report, there is information they may have approached a smuggler in Canada for help slipping past the U.S. border. ABC's Martha Raddatz joins us now. Martha, given this concern about this team of men, has the government upgraded its terrorism alert for the nation?
They have not upgraded the alert and are not considering it at this point. But with New Year's celebrations just hours away, police are intensifying the search for these missing men.
In New York City today, police officers, detectives, and the Joint Terrorism Task Force conducted a massive manhunt. But the search is not just limited to New York. Today, President Bush authorized an all-points bulletin for the men.
We need to know why they have been smuggled into the country, what they're doing in the country.
This is not like prior to 9/11, where we really had the leads and didn't follow them. This is one where, as soon as they got the leads, they started following them.
ABC News has learned that a known international smuggler and forger named Hamdani, arrested recently in Canada, told authorities that 19 men from Pakistan or neighboring countries had offered substantial amounts of money to enter the U.S. illegally, traveling from Pakistan through London and then through eastern Canada. Among the 19 are these five men the FBI believes entered the U.S. on Christmas Eve. Officials say even the smuggler Hamdani was suspicious of this group.
Normal smugglers will bring in families, two or three individuals who appear to be related. In this case, to bring in a group of five, maybe as many as 19 guys between the ages of 20 and 30 is odd.
Officials were especially uneasy about the number of men, 19, allegedly seeking forged passports. There were 19 hijackers on 9/11.
Even though the FBI has not uncovered any specific plot, Elizabeth, they are taking this very seriously.
All right, Martha Raddatz from Washington, thanks for that live report. On this New Year's Eve, the last United Nations weapons inspectors left North Korea today after being expelled by the North Korean government. There is now no way to tell if North Korea is building more nuclear bombs. President Bush spoke about both North Korea and Iraq at his ranch in Crawford, Texas today. ABC's John Cochran is with the president.
After 5 days out of sight at his ranch, the president took his wife for a cheeseburger at Crawford's best-known and only cafe. A chance, too, to tell Americans on New Year's Eve that war is not inevitable, either with Iraq or with North Korea.
I believe this is not a military showdown. This is a diplomatic showdown.
The president said he is counting on diplomatic help from North Korea's neighbors, Japan, China, and South Korea.
All options, of course, are always on the table for any president. But by working with these countries, we can resolve this.
On Iraq, the president seems less hopeful, but said war can still be avoided.
One of my New Year's resolutions is to work to deal with these situations in a way so that they're resolved peacefully. Thus far, it appears that first look, that Saddam Hussein hadn't heard the message.
But Mr. Bush bridled when a reporter suggested that war is looming.
I don't know why you say that. I hope we're not headed to war in Iraq. I'm the person who gets to decide, not you.
Despite all the dangers ahead, the president insisted that a year from today, the world will be safer than it is now. John Cochran, ABC News, Crawford, Texas.
On the Korean Peninsula, New Year's Eve was all about defying the U.S., even in South Korea, which the U.S. is supposedly protecting. ABC's Mark Litke reports from the South Korean capital of Seoul, where it is already 2003.
South Koreans greeted the new year with traditional temple bells and a massive anti-American protest. For weeks, Koreans have been venting their anger at the U.S. military here over the deaths of two schoolgirls crushed in a terrible accident by an American armored vehicle. But the demonstrations are now evolving into broader protests against U.S. policies toward North Korea. Koreans young and old are joining in and speaking out, demanding that the U.S. engage in dialogue with the North, not confrontation. We're not against American people, she says. We're against America's arrogant policies.
The South Korean government has repeatedly urged the demonstrators to tone down the anti-American rhetoric, fearing it will only embolden the North.
But even the president of South Korea, a longtime American ally, has criticized the Bush administration for its lack of diplomacy. As for North Korea, it welcomed the new year with several angry state-sponsored rallies, proclaiming its right to develop a nuclear program, warning the U.S. not to interfere. And on North Korean TV tonight, a New Year's variety show with a similar message. It's never too early to start showing defiance toward America. Mark Litke, ABC News, Seoul.
Now to another part of what President Bush calls the axis of evil. In Iraq, they are expecting full-scale war in the new year. ABC's Dan Harris reports from Baghdad.
In Baghdad's best restaurants tonight, the wealthy and westernized rang in the new year with food and dancing.
Average Iraqis, however, tend to celebrate quietly at home. New Year's isn't a big holiday here. There's no Times Square-style extravaganza. And in any event, no one's feeling very festive.
Even Tawfiq Yunus, who hosted this party at his restaurant tonight, admitted the celebration is only skin deep.
Can you feel very happy while you are under threat? Never. You cannot feel happiness while you are under pressure and a threat.
Although the U.S. continues to insist war is a last resort, people here seem resigned to the idea that war is likely, if not inevitable. Deputy Prime Minister Tariq Aziz met today with visiting American religious leaders. Aziz said if it were up to people like these church officials, war could be averted.
You know, this, it's not in their hands. It's, the situation is still in the hands of the warmongers.
On this New Year's Eve, there was a children's rally here in Baghdad. They alternated between chanting for peace and chanting down with Bush. Dan Harris, ABC News, Baghdad.
One other note about Iraq, the American military buildup has intensified. The army is sending about 16,000 more soldiers to the Persian Gulf. And the Navy ordered the USS Abraham Lincoln aircraft carrier to stay at sea rather than head home as scheduled. Still ahead, tighter security at the airports. All bags must now be checked for bombs. Can the screeners keep up?
The fact is, there will be some bags at some point in time that will not be checked for explosives.
We'll take a closer look at the year of the Sorcerer and the Ring and other huge hits for Hollywood. And counting down the five most memorable innovations of 2002, futuristic wheels already here.
This is World News Tonight with Peter Jennings, brought to you by Gateway.
My new baby's name is Max. He's waking up about now. My business partner's name is Joe.
This has everything you're looking for. It has
I see him more than I see Max. It's also my birthday. And I wouldn't mind working from home today. I'ma be
alright. Free double memory on select notebooks only at your Gateway store. Gateway 400 SP notebook PCs feature Intel Pentium 4 processors.
Showing folks how a packet of Hidden Valley Ranch changes regular chops into ranch chops.
It's got pizzazz.
And changes regular bread into ranch bread.
It's better than bread.
Hidden Valley Ranch. This changes everything.
When Publishers Clearinghouse arrives, we turn skeptics into believers.
You off for real?
Because I thought it was just actors on TV.
Very exciting to see that it's real.
This is like really reaffirming my faith.
Enter by mail or at PCH.com, and the next big winner could be you.
My brother Danny and me, for as long as I can remember, we've been competitive about everything. You got a new truck? I got a bigger one. I've got a family? He's got a bigger one. That's the way it's always been. And my doctor tells me to start taking an aspirin every day for my heart. Just one St. Joseph aspirin. It's smaller than a regular aspirin, but he says that's all I need. So maybe bigger isn't always better. Try telling him that.
St. Joseph Aspirin. Trust it with all your heart.
Have you tried Rolaid's two great new flavors? They're tropical, cool, smooth. New Tropical Punch and Cool Strawberry. Pick some fruit. Feel the relief.
Imagine combining the stain-fighting power of Efferdent and freshening power of Listerine. You'd get Efferdent Plus. It's extra fresh, and nothing gets your dentures cleaner. Efferdent Clean, Listerine Fresh.
Ah.
That's Efferdent Plus.
Airport security reaches a new level at midnight tonight when all checked baggage must be examined for explosives. It will not be easy for the new federal security screeners, especially since not all airports have the same equipment. The big question is, how will they make it work? ABC's Lisa Stark joins us now from Reagan National Airport with the answer. Good evening, Lisa.
Good evening, Elizabeth. It is a huge task to screen all bags for bombs. That's because passengers in the U.S. check an estimated 1.5 million bags every year.
The government is scrambling to meet its midnight deadline to screen all checked bags for explosives.
Check.
At Dallas-Fort Worth, some bomb detection machines like this one sit in crates. There's nowhere to put them. In Denver, dozens of handheld devices that detect traces of explosives were delivered yesterday. Most won't be in use until next week. At Boston's Logan Airport, they're still testing some of their bomb detection machines. Still, the airport insists it will be ready.
Tomorrow, 100% of the bags will be screened, and they'll be done very safely, very securely, but also very conveniently for the traveling public.
Passengers will find bag checks different at every airport. In Norfolk, Virginia, they are swabbing checked luggage, as many as 10,000 bags a day, to look for explosive residue.
What we try and do from a customer service angle is to talk people through the process, through exactly why we're doing what we're doing.
Most airports will rely on a variety of methods. The majority of bags will be checked by machine. The rest screened by bomb-sniffing dogs, searched by hand, or in a small number of cases simply matched to a passenger. Some critics argue that's a big hole in the system.
The fact is, there will be some bags at some point in time that will not be checked for explosives.
Now, the Transportation Security Administration insists that each and every bag will be screened in some fashion. But this is a work in progress, and it will take many more months to make this a comprehensive system. Elizabeth?
All right. Thanks so much, Lisa. When we come back, a magical year for the movies. Wizards help Hollywood make billions, even during a bad economy. That and more on this New Year's Eve.
Oh.
What's the matter, Frank?
Why'd I eat that pizza?
You love pizza.
I knew I'd get heartburn.
Didn't you start taking that prescription?
Yeah, but it won't kick in fully till tomorrow.
You have heartburn tonight.
Oh.
The leading prescription can take up to a day or more to fully work. It's not for occasional heartburn. Zantac 75 works fast, right when you need it. Even at night, when heartburn can be at its worst. Zantac, fast heartburn relief for people who hate to wait.
Oh.
Bob, you're snoring. Bob?
Had it with itching, flaking, dandruff? You need the Neutrogena T-Gel Power of Three. Unlike ordinary medicated shampoos, T-Gel works on all three major scalp conditions. Dermatologists recommend it number one. Stop the itching and flaking. Switch to Neutrogena T-Gel. It works.
35,000 dentists think enough of Crest White Strips to sell them in their offices. 10 million people have tried them. 4 out of 5 would recommend them. Crest White Strips. The secret to a whiter smile is in the strip.
Body pain? Oh. Back pain? Now relief is just a shuffle away. Introducing new Bear Extra Strength Back and Body. It soothes aching muscles and sore backs with the trusted strength of Bear Aspirin to work effectively at the site of pain. Plus, a special pain relief enhancer. Nothing works better than Bear Back and Body. Not Advil, not Tylenol. Get moving again, pain-free. New Bear Back and Body.
There's the all-protein diet. There's the all, you know, I hate my life diet. I did an all-garlic diet. Lost some friends that way.
Sure, I eat all my vegetables, especially cheese, onion rings.
Portion size is important. My doctor said never eat anything bigger than your hand or your fist. Never.
If these people can lose weight, so can you. A university study found that replacing 2 meals a day with a bowl of Special K or Smart Start cereals for 2 weeks could help you lose up to 6 pounds. Diet and exercise are important parts of a healthy lifestyle.
No, it's your hand because, you know, you can't survive on that.
Thursday, they can be as graceful as house cats, but these mysterious hunted creatures are becoming more scarce. Find out what it takes to save wild cougars on World News Tonight.
'02 was not a good year for the economy, but it was a great year for the film industry. Whether studios came out with better films, marketed them more effectively, or just gave Americans a welcome escape, the result was a blockbuster year at the box office. ABC's Brian Rooney takes a closer look.
The most amazing thing about Spider-Man is not that he does things like this.
It's that since the movie was released in May, it's earned $404 million, making it the fifth highest grossing movie of all time. Star Wars Episode II made $310 million. The second Harry Potter, $240 million. The amount of money movies made this year is no special effect. It's $9.4 billion real dollars.
I'd like to cash this check here, and then I'd like to take you out for a steak dinner.
Even adjusting for higher ticket prices, this year's gross and attendance is a big leap. Simply, people liked what they saw.
It's been a good year for movies.
A good year for certain kinds of movies. Of the top 10 grossing films this year, 5 were sequels.
Did you want to see some brochures?
The surprise of the year is My Big Fat Greek Wedding, a low-budget comedy the big studios wouldn't make, attracted an audience that paid $220 million to see it. But that was the exception to the rule of blockbusters.
The ones getting the most ink in your local newspaper will be the studio films that aspire to the broadest demographics.
What's also interesting about news of the box office gross is that it's news at all.
And the Lord of the Rings towered over Leonardo DiCaprio and Tom Hanks.
It made a towering $400 million around the world.
For some reason, Americans care. And the studios use the numbers like a winning sports score to attract fans.
It's just huge amounts of money, almost inconceivable, doing $200 million in less than 2 weeks. It just fascinates people.
Lost in the hype is a little-known fact that fewer people actually go to the movies than once did. The movies today sell less than 30 million tickets a week. In 1930, they sold 90 million tickets a week, a record set long before anyone ever dreamed of the blockbuster movie. Brian Mooney, ABC News, Hollywood.
Still ahead, the car of the future here today will count down 2002's 5 most intriguing innovations as our New Year's Eve broadcast continues.
Chilly nights at the firehouse mean heartburn and gas. These don't have the medicine to relieve both. But GasX with Maalox does, combining the heartburn relief of Maalox with the power of GasX to beat the burn and the bloat fast.
I think arthritis can change the way you perceive yourself, if you let it.
Fight back with Tylenol arthritis pain. Just 2 caplets in the morning have the strength to last all day.
Well, when I got hurt and missed work, glad I had supplemental insurance.
Supplemental insurance? What's that?
Aflac. Well, even best insurance doesn't give you cash to cover things like lost pay, other expenses. This does.
What does?
Aflac. Should ask about it at work.
Really? And what's it called?
Aflac!
Aflac. Ask about it at work.
Aflac!
In the beginning, I was nervous about other people holding her, or even changing her, and I had to have those pricey diapers.
Now, you take her. I know loves work great. They cost less, even without coupons. And leaks? I don't worry about leaks. They hold like the Hoover Dam, no matter who holds her. Her hugs are tight. Okay, my turn. Live and learn, and then get loves.
Now a new patch from Nicotrol has all the strength you need to help beat cigarettes one craving at a time and help prevent nicotine from disturbing your sleep. And with Nicotrol, you're twice as likely to succeed than with cold turkey. The new Nicotrol Step Down Patch helps beat cigarettes one craving at a time.
There's Carlina. She has never taken a single sick day, ever.
What's Carlina's secret? Tylenol cold severe congestion. It provides triple action nasal, chest, and head relief. Tylenol cold.
In this place, I see a lot of gas.
I also see a lot of folks taking medicines that don't fight gas. But GasX has the most powerful medicine to relieve gas fast.
Nothing I've seen works faster. GasX beats the bloat fast.
Bring in the new year with a college football celebration on ABC. Penn State faces Auburn in the Capital One Bowl. Washington State takes on Oklahoma in the Rose Bowl game presented by PlayStation 2. And Georgia meets Florida State in the Nokia Sugar Bowl. New Year's Day starting at 11 a.m. Eastern with the Tournament of Roses parade.
What do clones, plastic surgery, and male beauty makeovers have in common? Tomorrow, Good Morning America's Crystal Ball reveals the new year's new trends.
A brief review of the main story tonight. Thousands of law enforcement and officers are looking for a group of men who may have terrorist connections. The manhunt is nationwide, but particularly intense in New York, where officials have closed the city's harbor to recreational boats and placed very tight security around Times Square. Finally, this New Year's Eve, the conclusion of 2002, and our special series on the year's most notable newsmakers and news events. We wanted to look back tonight, but also to look ahead. So we're going to count down the most intriguing, interesting, and promising discoveries this year. Discoveries that could make a real difference next year. And for that, we go to our science correspondent, Ned Potter.
Perhaps in these anxious times, it was inevitable that someone would think of something that tracks your children by satellite.
Something that you could put on your child, and if your child got abducted, you'd be able to locate them.
So here's idea number five. A wristwatch with a pager, a panic button, and a global positioning system locator. A computer and 60 seconds are all you need to find your child. Idea number four might help find grown-ups, say if they've been in a building collapse or an earthquake. To that end, John Chapin and his team developed these remote-controlled rats.
Why couldn't we put a squad of search and rescue rats on an airplane and fly them there? In an hour, they'll be on the ground and they'll be out there searching for people under the rubble.
The rats wore tiny radio receivers on their backs with electrodes in the brain to tell them to turn. If they obeyed, another electrode would cause a feeling of intense pleasure.
They are stars in terms of their ability to get through various types of terrain.
There were other ideas this year that were, shall we say, more stunning, like this weapon that shoots painfully loud bursts of sound instead of gunshots.
This thing is point and shoot, and it's got an infinite number of bullets.
And take a look at this, a concept car from General Motors, which they built to run only on non-polluting hydrogen. While they were at it, they rethought the whole car. With all the power in the base, the body could be interchangeable, a sports car or a minivan, depending on your mood.
You could have a two-passenger vehicle off this. You could have a seven-passenger vehicle off this chassis.
Finally, we thought you'd like to meet Jeff Turner. His company made the strands of a spider web, one of the strongest materials in nature, but they did not use spiders. Instead, they did some genetic engineering, placing one spider gene in the DNA of a dairy goat. They will weave their new fibers into bulletproof vests or all-natural surgical thread.
Except for that one protein in their milk, are these goats any different from other goats?
No, indeed, these goats are, as you can see, very goatish. Their 70,000 goat genes make them goats.
From robo-rats to strands of DNA, one scientist said new ideas sometimes sound awfully futuristic, but perhaps the future is here. Ned Potter, ABC News, New York.
All week, our viewers have been voting on abcnews.com about what they think was the year's most important story. So which story is the winner? Well, you can visit abcnews.com for the results. And that's our report on World News Tonight. I'm Elizabeth Vargas. Have a great evening and a safe and happy New Year's Eve. For all of us at ABC News, good night.
Let the party start without you. It's Dick Clark's New Year's Rockin' Eve with B2K, Missy Elliott, Nelly, Rod Stewart, Third Eye Blind, and more. Be there with Dick Clark live in Times Square tonight starting at 10, 9 Central, only on ABC.
Good morning, Connecticut starts 6 a.m. Wednesday morning. We'll ring in 2003 and show you New Year's.
Take it easy, Prince Charming.
Hey, that was fast.
There's a place where magic lives. To get there, visit DisneyWorld.com.
I'll remember you, you remember me.
sister.
It's about that connection between me and you.
You're my very first friend.
I'm smiling now because I remembered you.
Send a card. They'll never forget you remembered.
It's as much fantasy as it is mystery. What is Cirque du Soleil? Every week, Bravo unveils the secrets of the world's most elite circus in our new reality series, Cirque du Soleil Fire Within.
Push yourself.
We follow their progress and their
skills. And not the words of one who kneels. The record shows I took the blows and did it my way.
Your future, your way. AXA, financial planning.
Dry skin is a nasty little problem, but extra dry skin, now that's a big problem. Fortunately, there's advanced therapy from Lubriderm with special nutrients and vitamins. Advanced therapy, later Gator.
Tried Rolaids lately? It's fruity, smooth, with a taste test-proof Tums can't beat. And extra-strength Rolaids quickly neutralizes 21% more acid than Tums EX. Rolaids spells fast relief with a taste that can't be beat.
Tonight, Dave's all new at the Late Show First, a U.S. soldier's marriage proposal from Afghanistan.
Do you know this guy?
Then Chicago star Renee Zellweger.
Is he looking?
No, I'm...
Was he looking?
I'm just here if you need me.
Plus, the dangerous mind of Chuck Barris.
You've killed people, haven't you?
This.org. Or call toll-free 1-877-GO-SOLVE.
On the next People's Court.
I told him I was going to report the van stolen.
She's a liar, Your Honor.
It's the mystery of the moving van.
Was your blind, crippled, and crazy uncle who can't drive anymore coming from the Bronx just to move the van from one part of the street to the other part of the street?
Judge Millian drives home the truth.
Perhaps the van has wings like Chitty Chitty Bang Bang.
I didn't have possession of the van at that time.
You are a liar.
On the next People's Court.
Monday at 4 on News Channel 8.
In the Northwest Hills, News Channel 8 is coverage you can count on.
What made news this week and what will make news tomorrow? This week with George.
This morning, a Sunday exclusive. The man who spent 3 days meeting with the North Koreans.
Our meetings were positive, constructive. I think they've eased tensions a bit.
New Mexico Governor Bill Richardson. Will North Korea back down? What will the United States do if they do not? Also with us, Republican Senator John McCain, who says it's time to get tough. Then, the Senate Minority Leader Tom Daschle. Now from our Washington headquarters, George Stephanopoulos.
Good morning, everyone. Fresh from 9 hours of talks with the North Koreans, our guest this morning is New Mexico Governor Bill Richardson. We'll get to him in a moment, but first, for a look at how the Bush administration is reacting to the talks, I'm joined here in the studio by ABC's diplomatic correspondent, Martha Raddatz. Thanks for being here, Martha.
Good morning, Judge.
Well, you heard Governor Richardson, positive, constructive. What is the State Department telling you?
Well, State Department officials are saying, basically, the North Koreans did not say what they wanted them to say, and that is, we're going to dismantle our nuclear weapons program. They didn't talk about those issues, according to some State Department officials familiar with these talks, and that's the only thing they want them to hear. What you've got here right now is sort of a game of chicken, and you've got South Korea in the middle. They're trying to defuse this any way they can.
So what is the administration going to do next?
There's a real split in the administration on this. Obviously, the State Department has already sent Assistant Secretary of State James Kelly to the region to try to negotiate, well, first of all, with South Koreans and anyone else in the region who will talk, excluding the North Koreans at this point. But these two tracks are this. Some in the administration want North Korea isolated, saying, look, the United States has known North Korea as a nuclear power for a long time. Let's just live with it. The other side of the administration, and this is mainly at the State Department, wants some sort of negotiation to go on, some sort of talk, some sort of engagement, not negotiate away anything, but some sort of engagement. And that's the split you're seeing in the administration. It's become really a problematic thing.
Well, are they close at all to resolving it?
I don't think they're close at all to resolving this. I mean, each side is pushing their point of view. The other side is standing up to it. In the meantime, everybody seems to be treading water.
Okay, Martha Raddatz, thank you very much. And now from Santa Fe, New Mexico, Governor Bill Richardson. Welcome, Governor.
Thank you, George.
Well, you heard Martha Raddatz say right there that the State Department view is that your talks didn't address the issues of real concern. Is that your view?
Well, I disagree with that analysis. I had a long conversation with Secretary Powell after my talks. He was satisfied. I mean, we're both very concerned about what the North Koreans are doing. But, you know, what always happens when you negotiate with the North Koreans, there's always the private position and the public position. Right now, they're intensifying the rhetoric. They're laying out their cards. They're being belligerent in preparation, I believe, for a negotiation. They always do that. I do think that in my talks, there were several nuances that might be useful. They did say that they're not going to build nuclear weapons. They did say to me that they're ready to negotiate the verification of some of their nuclear reprocessing facilities. They did say that they would talk to the administration about the uranium enrichment facility. They did say they wanted to improve relations with the U.S. But what they do, George, at various points in negotiating with the United States, and I was not a direct negotiator, is they step up the rhetoric. They make threats. They put more cards on the table. We're going to get out of the verification treaty of nonproliferation. We're going to engage in new missile tests. We're going to have a holy war. That's their tactic.
Well, that is their tactic. In fact, while the North Korean ambassador was talking to you in Santa Fe, New Mexico, their ambassador to China was saying they would resume new missile tests. And just this morning, the North Korean press reported that the North Koreans are now denying that they ever admitted to a uranium enrichment program to the United States back in October. And that's what kicked off this controversy in the first place. Is that what they told you?
Well, what they told me first on uranium enrichment, they said to me, they're ready to discuss that. Now, that's significant. That doesn't mean they're going to cave in. That means they want to negotiate. They also said to me that on verification of the international inspectors, the IAEA, which they've kicked out, they're ready to talk about that again. So what I think the administration needs to do, with all due respect, is just pick up the phone, start the preliminary talks at the UN in New York at a low level to set up broader talks that address these issues. I think that's what needs to happen. I think the administration has handled this issue well. I support their policy. They've now moved from containment, isolation, to a direct dialogue. But I agree with the administration that you don't engage in an immediate direct dialogue at the time the North Koreans are talking about holy wars and getting out of the NPT and taking other aggressive steps.
Well,
but
Governor,
that's part of their tactic.
Governor, you say the administration has handled this well, but since the breakdown in talks in October, North Korea has resumed work on their reactor. They've pulled out of the Nuclear Nonproliferation Treaty. The rhetoric has gone through the roof. Hasn't this policy of isolating North Korea, at least in the short term, failed?
Well, not necessarily, George. The North Koreans, they don't negotiate like we do. They don't have our same mentality. They're isolated. It's like a time warp of the 50s when you step into Pyongyang. They believe that in order to get something, they have to lay out additional cards, step up the rhetoric, be more belligerent. The key issue is what have they exactly done to damage the relationship? Well, their rhetoric has damaged things, but at the same time, they are sending comments through me, and I believe through other channels, that they're ready to talk, that they're ready to negotiate on freezing Yongbyon, that they're ready to negotiate on taking steps to get verification of their nuclear weapons, that they're taking steps to ease the tension. Now, it's all going to mean a negotiation, and it's all going to mean that the relationship eventually is not going to be a terrific one. But it's in our national interest, I think, to ease tensions. We've got a pending situation in Iraq. We've got the war on terrorism. We've got 37,000 American troops in South Korea. We've got allies in South Korea and Japan. We want Asia to be stable. So I think the next logical step is direct dialogue, direct engagement, and that's what the administration has said they are ready to do under proper conditions, and I think that's the right thing to do.
But, sir, did they ask you directly for a meeting at the United Nations with U.S. officials at the United Nations? And if they did, what did Secretary Powell say about that?
Well, I don't want to get into those direct talks, but I can say, George, that what I expect the next step to be is at the United Nations at a low level, some technical discussions, and I think that's very good. I think that probably will occur soon, that would lead to more substantive talks at higher levels. Now, I believe that my talks were responsible for easing tension a little bit, but I think what we have to really, and by the way, I think the administration deserves credit taking the suggestion from me that the North Koreans did want to talk. The administration could have said, oh, you know, that's a Democratic governor. We're not going to listen to him. They picked up and they said, all right, talk to them. Listen to them. Be in exploratory mode. And that's what I did. And I think the administration deserves credit for reaching out and allowing them to come to Santa Fe, have these 9 hours of talks. I think they're full of, I did a long report for Secretary Powell last night that I think has some useful nuances, useful points, useful additional private-public positions by the North Koreans that might be helpful should they engage in direct talks.
Why don't you try to flesh out a little some of those nuances for us right now? You're actually in the room where you spoke with the North Koreans. Give us a feel for what the meetings were like and what kind of hopeful signs, nuances were there in their presentations.
Well, I've known Ambassador Han for a long time. When I got some American pilots out of North Korea, he was one of the interlocutors. And, you know, North Koreans read from a script. They don't have the ability to negotiate directly because they have very strict instructions. But I would say to Han, I said, Han, you've been sent here to ease tensions to talk to me, but at the same time, your officials in Pyongyang are withdrawing from the Non-Proliferation Treaty. You're taking aggressive steps. This is not very conducive for the Bush administration to want to talk to you. And you know, he would give me a little smile, and then, you know, without getting into specifics, once again, and this is very important, the North Koreans always have a very aggressive public position when they're going to enter into negotiations. I think this is what's happening. I think withdrawing, by the way, from the NPT is generally symbolic because the NPT, they weren't really in it. They kind of got in it, but saying they're withdrawing, it's the press hype about it that is damaging. And I agree it is not a good image to send. But technically, I don't think it's that serious. Now, these are guys that have aggressive designs. And what is best for us is not to give them overly heavy attention, but it doesn't make sense also to provoke them. And if I must say, the axis of evil statement in the past was not helpful here.
But Governor, you know,
I think the administration is now in a policy of direct dialogue under proper conditions, bringing countries in Asia and the international community, the IAEA, basically to say, you've got to freeze your nuclear activity, building international support for our position. And I think that's where we should be.
You have spent several hours over the last decade negotiating with the North Koreans on prisoner release and things like that. In addition to these talks, you know them well. And there's a big debate going on now about what the North Koreans are really after. As you say, is this just bargaining chips, or are they really out now to build a credible nuclear deterrent, build those 5, 6, or 7 weapons? What do you think?
Well, look, they're the poorest nation in the world. I think eventually they want food assistance, they want investment from the West, they want to engage with the West, but they still can't get away from their aggressive tactics. Their big card, their only card, is that they probably have 2 nuclear weapons, that they have reprocessing of uranium facilities, that they have 1.5 million troops on the border. So they use those cards to get what they want. They also have a mindset that they demand international respect. They want to deal directly with the United States, not with South Korea. They want to be considered big major powers. Now, we shouldn't give them everything they want, and hardly, in fact, anything that they want. But we do have to recognize that this is a nuclear power, that it's in our national interest to talk to them, to ease tensions in Asia, to have South Korea, our strong ally, not in the cusp of an invasion. And so what makes sense is direct talks. And I think my discussions here in Santa Fe have led to those, hopefully, direct talks that will happen soon. All I wanted to do was be a good American. I think foreign policy should be bipartisan. I think the administration deserves credit for reaching out to me as a Democrat. I think you know, having people like John McCain, experts on this issue, is important. So I was very glad to try to be helpful, but I wasn't an envoy, George. But I do think there's enough information in my talks that I passed on that could lead to easing of tensions and possibly direct talks.
But do you believe that if they actually begin to reprocess the spent fuel into plutonium for bombs, that will be a red line, they'll have gone past the point of no return, and the United States will have to take military action?
Well, I think that would be a very bad step, and I urge the North Koreans to not even think about it, to stay away from that, to not even have hot rhetoric on it.
What did they tell you?
I think they understand that. I think they understand that, George, but at the same time, I think it's important that direct talks happen. I can't stress how important that is. And it can be at the technical level, low level, starting to higher level. And I think there's nothing wrong with that. We have very skilled diplomats. I think that Secretary Powell has been very skilled in handling this. He was my direct contact in these talks. He's tough, but at the same time, I think that we all realize, and President Bush has said it, he's ready to have a direct dialogue, and I think that's what has to happen next.
Senator McCain thinks that it's time for the U.S. to go to the United Nations and go for sanctions. What's your reaction to that idea?
Well, I love Senator McCain, and you know, I hate to be on the wrong side of him because he's such a good guy and good senator, but I don't think that should be an option. I think eventually, yes, if it adversely affects our interests. I think you first have to go through diplomacy, and then I believe you have to engage your allies in the region, China, Japan, South Korea, the United Nations. I see the Australians are coming in. I think that's healthy to bring the North Koreans into a framework of discussions, but eventually it's going to be the United States. What we don't want, George, is a potential altercation that if we take military action, you've got 1.5 million North Korean troops, quite aggressive on the border, on the DMZ, where 37,000 American troops are, where there's a South Korean nation that is our friend. Everybody agrees that you want to ease tensions, and I think if you move the North Koreans in the right direction, basically what I would suggest also, George, is a bilateral, non-aggression, binding pact that basically says the United States is ready to agree that North Korea is not going to be treated in an aggressive, hostile fashion. In other words, that we're not going to attack North Korea in exchange for some of the steps that are needed. A freezing of the Yongbong plant, reprocessing facility, discuss that, possibly eliminate it. Verification of the nuclear weapons programs of North Korea, allowing the inspectors from the international community, the IAEA, to come back in, finding ways to freeze their nuclear activity so that they just use it for peaceful purposes. Finally. The North Koreans said they're ready to do that, but only after a negotiation.
Finally, sir, we're just about out of time here, but I did want to get to one domestic issue. You gave the Democratic radio address yesterday on the president's economic plan. There was no aid to the states in the president's economic plan, and you've pushed for up to $50 billion in aid. Would you accept a deal from the president to accept his tax cuts in return for this state aid?
Well, I think the president's tax cuts, some of them go in the right direction. The middle class tax cut, the provision that deals with marriage penalty, the tax credit for kids. I would change it a little bit, weigh it more to the middle class and those that don't benefit as much. But what I would like to see is Medicaid assistance to the states. This is really, the states are in the worst fiscal situation in years. Education assistance, so it's not unfunded mandates, no child left behind. Homeland security funds also, George, that are needed here for police and fire. Unemployment assistance for those that have lost their jobs. In my state, it's 6%. So I think there has to be a package of assistance to the states. Our national and economic security is tied to how fiscally strong the states are. And in the president's package, it was a bit lacking there.
Governor Richardson, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks, George.
And now for another view on the conflict with North Korea, we turn to Senator John McCain, who joins us from Cottonwood, Arizona. Good morning, Senator.
Morning, George.
Well, you heard Governor Richardson. What's your reaction?
Well, my reaction is that facts are stubborn things. In 1994, when the Clinton administration negotiated this agreement, many of us objected vociferously because we believed that that North Korea would continue to develop nuclear weapons, which is indeed the case. They've withdrawn from the IAEA. They are saying they've kicked out the IAEA inspectors. They say they are withdrawing from the Nuclear Proliferation Treaty, Non-Proliferation Treaty, and they are making other ominous sounds. The facts are that it is a clear and present danger to the United States of America. They've now developed at least two nuclear weapons. If the situation continues as it is, they will have six or eight more. That gives them an enormous amount of flexibility. They've tested a missile that could strike Tokyo, and they're developing missiles that can strike the United States of America. The United States needs to take vigorous action with our allies, but if not, on our own.
You've called for the United States to go to the UN Security Council, but if North Korea continues forward and actually moves to reprocess that spent fuel into plutonium, would you support military action?
First of all, I think it would be a mistake to rule out military action today, although it must be the last option because of the threat that we face. Look, we need to go to China and tell them that they need to help us. We need to have the South Koreans understand that the threat increases rather than decreases. Japan is now clearly vulnerable, and we may have to remove any objections that we have to them developing nuclear weapons in order to defend themselves. But our first step should be go to the United Nations, ask for multilateral sanctions against North Korea. Look, we have given them millions and millions of dollars in oil and food while 2 million of their own citizens have starved to death. This is an Orwellian Stalinist regime ruled by a sociopath, and they have violated every agreement that they have ever made with us, particularly that in 1994, which was a terribly flawed agreement. And the danger in 1994 was there. It's far more severe today. So the question is not what dangers do we face if we have to confront North Korea. The question is what are the dangers we face if they continue, as they show have every indication of doing, to develop a nuclear inventory?
And that means that if they did continue, then you would see no option but to take military action.
Well, it's the last option, but my first step would be to put the squeeze on them economically. China has enormous influence over them. They are the reason why they're so badly off economically is not because of any policy of the United States. It's because they have a Stalinist regime, which is so Orwellian in nature that many Americans who don't know a lot about it would be astounded that in every home there's one radio station that is allowed to be listened to. I mean. But more importantly, they have broken the agreement that we made in 1994. Then Secretary of Defense Perry, who disagreed with me and supported the agreement, said if they break this agreement, then we would have to consider a military option. This is a crisis.
And you've also had some tough words for the administration's approach. You wrote an article in the Weekly Standard this week where you called the policy reckless and disingenuous, and then you added, "The Bush administration now appears to have embraced and in some respects exceeded the style and substance of Clinton's diplomacy." Now, you know those are fighting words to this White House, and you generally do agree with the Bush administration on national security matters, even though you disagree on domestic matters. How do you explain why they've taken this approach, which you consider so wrongheaded?
Well, it's hard for me to divine why the administration has taken certain actions, but one of them is that obviously Iraq is the priority right now. And by the way, the situation in Korea is an argument for taking care of Saddam Hussein so that he doesn't acquire weapons of mass destruction as the North Koreans have, which complicates it increasingly dangerous fashion. So I don't know why. I know that it would stretch our military very thin. We reduced the size of our military all through the 1990s after the Persian Gulf War. But the fact is that if the North Koreans continue on the path that they are on, some months from now, we may face a ever more capable North Korea with an increasing nuclear weapons inventory. That makes it even more dangerous because their options then are increased.
Senator McCain, thank you very much.
Thank you, George.
We'll be right back.
When This Week returns, Senate Minority Leader Tom Daschle on President Bush's plan to stimulate the economy and why he isn't running for president. Then our roundtable, George Will, Michelle Martin, and Todd Gitlin of Mother Jones Magazine. This Week with George Stephanopoulos, brought to you by Charles Schwab. There's never been a better time for Charles Schwab.
I don't like being pressured into anything, especially not decisions regarding my money.
When my old broker used to call, my first thought was always, what's he trying to sell me now?
In the past year, investors moved more than $30 billion to Charles Schwab.
At Charles Schwab, there's no pressure. No one's calling us up to buy this or sell that.
There is no latest, greatest hot stock tip.
They treat me as though I'm a person, not an account or just a number.
They treat me like they want me around for the next 30, 40, whatever years. I appreciate that.
Come see why there's never been a better time for Charles Schwab.
We go through this every time. Red.
Blue.
Leather.
Cloth.
Whoa. Now that's a car.
No, that's my car. I built it on the web, and they sent me that the next day. Printed and personalized. My color, my interior, where to go. They even gave me a free CD player. It can be here in a week.
Well, at least we talked about it.
We're back with the Senate Minority Leader, Tom Daschle. Good morning.
Good morning, George.
Well, you heard the two views there. Governor Richardson says it's time for direct talks with the North Koreans. Senator McCain says, no, we have to isolate them, go for sanctions at the United Nations. What do you think?
George, I think there are two things we have to do. First of all, we have to take all actions necessary to dismantle this nuclear assembly line that North Koreans have. And secondly, we have to express in no uncertain terms that we have no hostile intentions. The best way to do that is to do what the governor suggested, that we enter into direct talks. What other options are available to us down the road may be something we'll want to consider. But clearly today, direct talks must be done. And I think dismantling, without any question, that nuclear assembly line has got to be the highest priority for this country.
He also said that the United States should do what one of the incoming South Korean president suggested, sign a security guarantee of some sort. What do you think of that?
Well, I don't know that anything needs to be signed at this point. I think that ought to be the subject of discussions. Clearly, we've got to work with our allies in the region to try to find out what framework might work best. That's a possibility. I don't think we ought to commit to anything until we are absolutely confident that they are going to dismantle that nuclear assembly line.
Okay, let's turn to the economy. This week you called the Bush economic plan obscene, but it doesn't look like the president's about to back down. In fact, this week he sent out one of his biggest guns, Vice President Cheney, to defend the plan. And I want to show something he said on Friday at the Chamber of Commerce.
We must weigh the cost of the president's proposals against the cost of an economic slowdown that might well take place if the president's growth package is not enacted. If the economy were to grow just one percentage point slower for the next 2 years than we anticipate, then the budget deficit over the next 10 years would be almost $800 billion larger than expected.
Well, that low-key demeanor is masking a pretty big threat. They basically are saying that if the Democrats don't go along with the tax package, the economy is going to falter and it's going to be your fault.
George, this is a stimulus for the rich and a sedative for the rest. There is absolutely no stimulus in the first year. 10% of the stimulus package takes effect this year. By their own acknowledgement, they create 190,000 jobs in the first year. Well, you know, we lost 100,000 jobs in December alone, 2.2 million jobs in the last 2 years. There is no stimulus. That's number one. Number two, it is so unfair. Not only are they not taxing dividends, they're going to continue to tax the paychecks. But I think the most unfair part of this is that you've got soldiers, including 1,000 in South Dakota, going to the Middle East right now, willing to put their lives on the line at the very time this administration is saying we're going to give $89,000 in a tax break to every millionaire in this country, not only this year, but every year. Finally, it's reckless, very reckless. We're going to borrow every dollar. We're going to be taxing, we're going to be drawing down the resources to states by another $4 billion, and we're going to war. So, or at least possibly going to war, and if that's the case, it just seems to me this is one of the most reckless fiscal policies this president or any president has put forth in many years.
Well, sir, that's very strong rhetoric, and it's similar to what you said when we were fighting the original Bush tax package in 2001, but at that time you failed to hold the Democrats together against the package, and already you see some signs this year that the Democrats may reach out to support President Bush. I want to show you something that Evan Bayh, a senator who actually voted against the 2001 tax package, but now he seems to support this one. He said, as long as those tax reductions are on the books anyway, it doesn't do much to stimulate the economy today to promise somebody a tax cut in 3 or 4 years. You may as well put them into effect at a time when you need them, which is when the economy is sluggish. He's saying, say, they're already on the books, we might as well do it now.
Well, that's one aspect of this president's plan, and clearly there may be some Democrats who support it. But I tell you, I, having talked to all of my caucus on a number of occasions, I'm absolutely confident that that our Democrats feel much more strongly about this tax plan than they did the last one. They realize now that a mistake was made in many cases. We are devastating the economy. We are increasing the debt. We are creating fiscal havoc here in ways that many of them didn't anticipate. So the experience of the last 2 years has served as a real guide, and I am confident that that we're going to have a lot more votes than we did the last time. And I am also confident that we can put forth a Democratic plan that counts on that really calls for an immediate tax reduction, an immediate stimulus, one that's fair, one that's fiscally responsible, and one that helps the states.
But you haven't done that yet.
We have. Actually, the chairman of the Finance Committee has put out a very comprehensive plan. Nancy Pelosi and the Democratic leadership in the House has put an almost identical plan on the table in the House. So,
but are you saying that the Max Baucus is the Finance Committee chairman, ranking member, not chairman, that his plan will be the unified Democratic plan in the Senate?
What I'm saying is that the Democrats will present a plan. This is the Baucus plan is a very good beginning that will do the things that I've just mentioned. Stimulate the economy now. Create the kind of fiscal response that we need. Make sure that it's really targeted to the middle class and make sure we help states. We can do that, and I think we're going to be very unified as we present that alternative. Clearly, it's better than what this administration is proposing. If you take in the interest rates and the extension of the permanent tax cuts, you're talking about another $1.3 trillion, George. That is reckless. That is risky. That's not something we should do.
You say this is a tax plan for the wealthy, but aren't you worried at all that the administration may really have you over a barrel here politically? They say they're reaching out to the 74 million Americans who have some money in the stock market. These are the new swing voters, the investor class, and the Democrats are going to lose either way. If you block this plan, you're going to turn off those voters forever.
Well, there is a lot we can do to target the middle class. In fact, there's some that the administration has supported that we would support as well. The marriage penalty relief, the child care credit, the kinds of things that we've talked about that would help the middle class, clearly we're willing to support. But I can't imagine that an American today, with all the prospects of war, with all the unfairness that we see, with sacrifice for some and a giveaway for others, is something that the American people can support. $89,000 for every millionaire in this country each and every year as we contemplate war is the most unfair and reckless approach that I think this administration could put forth.
Let me turn to another proposal the president made this week. He also renominated Judge Charles Pickering of Mississippi to the Federal Appeals Court. Will you support a filibuster of that nomination?
George, I think this really lays bare the administration's real position on civil rights. This exposes the Southern strategy clearly. There is no doubt in my mind. We now know from where they come. And we're going to do everything we can to stop that nomination on the floor and in the committee.
Including a filibuster.
Including a filibuster.
But, you know, defenders of Judge Pickering say that the Democrats are just race baiting. They point out, for example, the Democrats have made a big deal about the fact that Judge Pickering reduced the sentence of someone convicted of cross-burning, but he also reduced sentences in cases for African Americans, so it has nothing to do with race.
You look through his history, not only as a judge, but as a state legislator and in many other capacities, George, and there is no question. His insensitivity to civil rights, to equal rights, especially to minorities, is something that is well documented. This man does not deserve to be in the second highest court in the land, and we're going to do everything we can to stop it.
Finally, sir, you did make a big decision this week. You decided not to run for president, and it really did surprise a lot of people. Just last Saturday, you were out in South Dakota saying you were leaning toward a run. Monday night, you were, I think, from all our reporting, interviewing staff members for your campaign. You were planning an announcement on Saturday in South Dakota. You were planning trips to New Hampshire and Iowa. Then you went home that night, talked to your family at 11 o'clock, pulled the plug. What happened in those 3 hours?
Well, it was just a question of where my passions lie, you know, and I just didn't feel like I could be leader and be candidate at the same time. I love what I'm doing. I love the fact that I'm a senator from South Dakota. I love the opportunity to play the leadership role that I have. I was just not ready to give it up at this time. Maybe someday, but right now my passion is the Senate, my passion is South Dakota, and that's where I want to stay.
Maybe someday. You open that door real wide, far into the future. Senator Daschle, thank you very much.
My pleasure, George.
We'll be right back.
When This Week returns, our roundtable's take on the Bush economic plan, the return of a controversial judicial nominee, and an unexpected gift for death row inmates in Illinois. Plus, George will on taxing the toys of the rich, a tax plan that ended up costing everyone money.
Where are the cars we were promised? The dream cars. The problem-solving cars. Where are the cars that are more than just cars? They're closer than you think. Cars with voice recognition. Cars with intelligent cruise control. And a class-leading 340 horsepower engine. The Q45. From Infiniti.
If you have a cold and high blood pressure, you should know that decongestants in these medicines can raise your blood pressure. So why take them? Take decongestant-free Coracetin HBP. Powerful relief that won't raise your blood pressure.
What is it?
Pixie dust.
Pixie dust.
Pixie dust? Magic self-healing server pixie dust.
How's it work?
Server goes down, sprinkle on the pixie dust, server's back up. Use it regularly and servers solve their own problems. Easy.
I like it.
What's it cost?
It's cheap.
Cheap.
Soy-based.
Soy-based.
Biodegradable.
Looks like we got a winner.
Hey, hey, it's a new generation of allergy relief. Claritin, the most prescribed allergy medicine, is now available without a prescription. Clarity for mind, body, and spirit. Prescription strength, non-drowsy Claritin, now available without a prescription.
Golden Globe nominee Jennifer Garner is on a mission you can't miss.
Dad, get in!
Tonight, this spy finally gets together with another.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
And their first date is a killer.
Sit behind you.
The Lover's Mission on a new alias, ABC Tonight, followed by The Practice. Sergeant Joe Friday, Detective Frank Smith. They're going to solve the most violent crimes in LA's history. If the bad guys don't kill them first. From the creator of Law and Order comes the return of the grittiest crime drama of them all. Dragnet premieres Sunday, February 2nd on ABC.
The roundtable weighs in on President Bush's economic plan and Governor Ryan's historic decision on the death penalty. After this from our ABC stations.
This week on World News Tonight, the epidemic now facing younger women. Find out why and what this new technology can reveal about how your mind works on World News Tonight.
See how you can buy quality unpainted furniture at Furniture Solutions in Wallingford or Route 1 in Brantford, Sunday night at 11:35 on Connecticut Business Today.
When we started going on the air and talking about coverage you can count on, I said, yeah, that's what we do in the Weather Center.
No matter where you live in Connecticut, Storm teammates Jeff Fox has you covered.
We have the shoreline, we have the hills, we have the Connecticut River Valley, so it's a real challenge, and I want you to depend on me.
When winter weather hits hard, it's breaking news.
Cold enough for snow throughout the entire state, including the shoreline.
And when a storm strikes, News Channel 8 is there with the latest forecast from the Storm Team 8 Weather Center. Snow and road conditions from around the state, plus delays and closings. All of the information is on air and online at WTNH.com. You make your plans based on the weather, and it's our job to do it right. Storm Team 8, for winter weather coverage you can count on.
Get 0% interest for 3 years during our winter home sale. Bassett Furniture.
This morning, Todd Gitlin, a columnist for Mother Jones Magazine and a professor at Columbia University. Welcome.
Thanks, George.
Well, George, let me start out with the economic plan. The president's plan was big. It was bold, $674 billion at least, much bigger than anyone really expected, and maybe more than the traffic can bear. What's the theory behind this in-your-face strategy?
First of all, it's big, but not relative to the economy. Over the next 10 years, and we're talking 10-year projections here, the nominal GDP of this country is going to be $130-some trillion. This is a drop in the bucket. This is called, but not often by the Bush people, a stimulus program, because it won't stimulate particularly. The Congress can't stimulate with what it has, which is fiscal policy, taxes. The Fed can stimulate with monetary policy, but after 12 rate cuts in the last 2 years, it's out of bullets. So in fact, this is a way of changing the structure of the economy, and that's all.
Well, except that the administration did argue that their initial foray into tax cutting was a stimulus plan, which it seems to have been. The interesting thing about this is there's no objective truth here. I mean, I worked at the Wall Street Journal, so I think I'm entitled to make economist jokes. Mm-hmm. And one of them is that if you want five opinions, ask four economists. And so they're really, it's a question of values, it's a question of ideology. Of course, the thing that you're going to hear is that this favors the rich, that the rich get most of the benefits, and that is certainly true. But it is true that the wealthiest families in America pay most of the taxes, and they pay a lot more of the taxes than they did 30 years ago. It is also true that they get a bigger share of the nation's income than they did 30 years ago, and that's the basis for the Democratic argument that if you really want to do something to sort of, what it's also interesting is that you're not hearing a lot more about income inequality, really. I mean, the Democrats are talking about doing something to stimulate the economy on the margins, but you're really not talking about redressing fundamental inequalities in the income distribution of the country. It just shows the way that the debate has changed over the last 10 or 15 or 20 years.
So, Todd, are the Democrats missing a bet?
Well, if I were they, I would say if it's not a stimulus package, what's it doing here? I mean, it seems to me that it's a reflection of a country club view of the world. It's a stimulus for the country club and the traditional Republican view that if you serve those who don't need to be served, that the little people will benefit as well. In the meantime, the states are starving. We just heard a bit about that. I read the other day that the Republican governor of Ohio, can't get any more Republican than a man named Robert Taft, says there's going to be a $580 million shortfall next year just in Ohio as a result of these cuts. And as an educator, I'm mindful of what is not coming down the pike to students, to universities, to the education program that the president ran on.
You know what else is interesting? 4 out of 10 families now pay more in payroll taxes than they do in federal income taxes. Mm-hmm. And so that suggests that if you really want to do something to address the concerns of the middle class, what you need to talk about are Social Security and health care, because that's where those payroll taxes go. They go to Social Security and Medicare taxes, and Medicare and Medicaid are the big, education and health are the big cost savings for the states, and that is really where the crunch is going to come, those are the programs that are being hurt the most by the fall off of
state
revenues.
I think the Democrats really are making a redistributionist argument when they say this favors the rich, and they're trying to stir up something that can't be stirred in America, which is envy. If Todd went into the Lowe Library, he would find the shelves groaning beneath the weight of dust-laden doctoral dissertations trying to explain why socialism has never made it in America. And the answer is, Americans don't envy, they aspire. The fact is, the average American thinks that, well, he understands that of all the seven deadly sins, envy's the one that doesn't give the sinner even momentary pleasure. We're just not an envious country.
Well, fairness is a legitimate argument, though.
Sorry. Go ahead. I never understood why people wouldn't aspire just as hard if they didn't get a tax cut at the top brackets. I mean, I really don't think that during the period when the tax brackets were much higher, that we lacked aspiration to get rich.
I'm explaining why those who are not in the top tax brackets are not resenting those in the top right. Can I show you a graphic? Because we're talking about the rich, and I want to find out who's rich.
You are.
Let me show you, let me show you this. The average salary of an Illinois public school teacher is $50,000. The minimum salary of a Chicago police sergeant is $54,000. That means their household income is well into the top 10% of household incomes in this objectively rich country. Are they rich?
No.
They're not rich. So where do the rich start if they're not at $104,000?
Yeah, but the data shows that fewer people think of themselves as rich, even though people who are objectively rich, people who make incomes in the high six figures. It's a curious question.
It's a curious question, and George, I'm actually glad you brought up that that chart, because you've pointed out exactly the family that may actually end up getting their taxes increased the way the tax system is working right now because of the way the alternative minimum tax is working. And the Bush plan said nothing about the alternative minimum tax. That is a huge, huge train wreck coming down the road, probably in the next year or two. But let's switch subjects now and talk. I just asked Senator Daschle about Charles Pickering. He says that the man has a history of racial insensitivity. He says basically the Democrats are going to filibuster. George, you think they can succeed?
It's a dangerous, dangerous precedent to start filibustering, particularly about a man your complaint against which is he's insensitive. That's what you say when you really don't have very much involved. This is a man endorsed by his local NAACP in Mississippi, a man who sent his children to predominantly African-American public schools. I'd like to see a show of hands. All the Democratic senators have done the same thing. Not many, I wager. This is a man who testified against the Klan, and he's being attacked for being insensitive.
I don't believe the issue is whether he's insensitive any more than the issue is whether he buys Girl Scout cookies from the kids who come around the office, whether he tips the parking lot attendant. I think the issue is his judicial record. It's also his record as a public official. And he has a high rate of reversal. The argument here is that his particular areas seem to be ones where he doesn't seem to either know the law or he's insensitive to the law or he's ignorant of the law.
Yet the ABA says he's highly qualified.
Well, you know, and also I don't think it's accurate that the NAACP has endorsed him. I think every local NAACP in Mississippi has actually opposed his nomination. I think the real issue is, and people have, I think really the bigger question is, do groups have a right to question someone's record
sure.
without saying that they're accusing him of being a racist? And their argument is that his judicial philosophy would expand discrimination and limit penalties. Is that or is that not a legitimate area to contest in a confirmation question?
Sorry, I think it's actually a lot worse than that. He testified in the first judicial round of hearings in 1990 that he'd never had any contact with an organization with a very innocuous name, the Mississippi State Sovereignty Commission. Now, what that was a secret police apparatus set up by the state of Mississippi to fight against racial integration. And he said he'd never had any contact with it. Now, online now, because their documents have been put online as a result of a lawsuit, is a memorandum dated January 5th, 1972, to the head of the State Sovereignty Commission, which is about an effort to prevent left-wing organizers from helping to organize a union. And at the end of this memo, we read that a number of state representatives and I'm quoting here, Senator Charles Pickering, that is state senator, are very interested in this matter and requested to be advised of developments in connection with this infiltration of a union. When asked about this later, Pickering said, well, he was concerned about the Klan infiltration of the union. That's not true. He was knee-deep in this organization. As a state senator, he voted to fund the State Sovereignty Commission. His law partner was one of the leaders of it and a white supremacist in the strict sense who had been down the line for racial segregation. So he has not come clean.
Well, I think the bigger question, though, is what record is the Bush administration laying out on questions of race and civil rights? And it's a very interesting strategy that I think that they're pursuing. On the one hand, I mean, you know, whether, I don't think Mr. Pickering is really the issue. I think in one sense he's kind of a loss leader here. I mean, I don't think the administration minds if he loses. He's an older gentleman. He wouldn't have very long to serve on the bench if he were to serve. I think that really he's meant to expend the political energy of the Democrats so that they can get their other nominees through. So that they can then accuse him of being obstructionist when they send their younger and equally conservative and with lesser records of lesser public records down the line. So I really think that's the purpose of this. But what the question is this is an administration that has been very aggressively focused on expanding the party. And so the question is, expanding the party with what kind of message, even as they're continuing to try to assert their conservative principles on racial matters to their conservative base, and how they mediate that is going to be a very interesting question
and
the next
they're in a pickle
year,
this so. Week. I mean, this week, George, they're supposed to decide whether or not to file a brief opposing the University of Michigan at the Supreme Court because of their affirmative action program. And what puzzles me is why it's taken so long for the administration to make this decision. The Attorney General sent forward a brief. The President says he's against affirmative action. Why doesn't he just come out and support the Attorney General?
I haven't the slightest idea. University of Michigan has a huge 14th Amendment equal protection problem. An African American, a Native American, or a Hispanic American applying to the undergraduate school gets 20 points just because of color of the skin or ethnicity, 20 points added out of a possible 150. If you get a perfect 1600 on your SATs, you only get 12 points. This is a blatant racial preference in the interest of diversity, and there is no diversity exception, either in the Constitution or in constitutional law, for violating equal protection.
One of the arguments, I think one of the reasons that they've taken so long is that some of their most visible Black and Hispanic members are in favor of affirmative action. I think one could argue that Pete Wilson single-handedly destroyed minority outreach efforts for the California Republican Party by attacking affirmative action. That's the third rail for African American and Hispanics, because they see educational opportunity as so critical to their advancement in society, and that's one reason I think they've hesitated.
Michelle, you get the last word today. Sorry about that, Todd, and sorry we didn't get to Governor Ryan's decision. I'm sure we'll get to that in the future. And when we come back, George Will bids good riddance to attacks that died.
This week's Roundtable, brought to you by Microsoft. Your potential, our passion. For more information, log on to abcnews.com.
We see a mom and a CEO. Big business made agile. We see Teacher of the Year. We see 400 employees in 3 years. We see the toughest reservation in town. 23-city tour. At Microsoft, we stand in awe of you and your potential. It's what inspires us to create software that helps you reach it.
With advanced off-road technology, third-row seats, and a powerful 4.7-liter V8 engine, the new Lexus GX is an adventure in luxury.
Okay, so it's true.
What's true?
Drug money funds terrorism.
It is true.
Okay.
Okay?
Look, let's say I buy some dope.
Let's say.
Hypothetical.
Let's say.
Now, how much of my money actually makes it to the bad guy's hands? A couple of bucks.
A few bucks.
A few bucks, that's it. Peanuts.
So what you're saying is it's okay to support terrorism a little.
Did I say that?
Tuesday, a cop is busted.
Somebody planted dope in my car.
How far will his squad go to prove he's been framed? An all-new Blue, ABC Tuesday, 10, 9 Central.
We investigate strange things.
On Monday, January 27th, the signs are everywhere.
My work is freaking weird.
There's my death.
What does it want?
Everything.
Miracles happening Monday, January 27th on ABC. Viewer discretion is
advised. George, something unusual has happened. A tax has died.
George, critics say the president's tax proposals favor the rich at the expense of ordinary people. Maybe, maybe not. But a recent event reminded us of the perils of taxing the rich to help common folks. 12 days ago, the luxury tax on expensive cars expired. It was the last of the luxury taxes that the first President Bush signed in 1990 as part of the budget agreement in which he broke his read my lips, no new taxes pledge. The agreement was brokered by this senator, George Mitchell of Maine, then majority leader, and the luxury tax was supported by this senator, Ted Kennedy from Massachusetts. The luxury tax applied not just to cars, but to jewelry, furs, and private planes, and to expensive boats, yachts. Congress estimated that in 1991, these luxury taxes would rake in $31 million, but the actual sum was just $16.6 million. Why? Because, to the surprise of no one except tax-raising politicians, the luxury taxes cause people to buy less jewelry and fewer expensive cars, planes, and especially yachts. The tax destroyed jobs, an estimated 25,000 of them in the boat building industry, much of which is in New England, in Senator Mitchell's Maine and Kennedy's Massachusetts. The job losses cost the government more than $24 million in unemployment benefits and lost income tax revenue. So the luxury tax actually cost the government money. New England's boat building industry was so devastated that by 1999, another Kennedy, that Ted's son Patrick, a Rhode Island congressman, actually proposed a federal subsidy to help rich people buy yachts. He called it, quote, exactly the opposite of a luxury tax. Remember this costly farce when you hear talk about helping the common folks by taxing the rich.
Thank you, George. I'll be back with a look at how the Republicans are dealing with the fallout from the Trent Lott controversy.
Dave.
Larry.
How is that Dell consolidation going?
TCO's down.
Uptime?
Highly available.
Great.
And you?
Well, you know, we're still running a proprietary Unix-based system.
Right.
Dell Flexible Solution with Dell PowerEdge servers and Intel Xeon processors can help manage your enterprise for less. Easy as Dell. Call or go online today.
I moved my money to Charles Schwab because my dad gave me advice that I actually chose to listen to for once.
I moved my money to Charles Schwab because I did my homework.
With Schwab, I can go to sleep at night now. I don't get nightmares anymore.
It gives me a level of comfort that I didn't have at my old broker.
I moved my money to Charles Schwab so I can spend more time with my kids and less time worrying about my money.
You know, they do care and they do want to know, as your life changes and as you grow, how can they help you?
In the past year, investors moved more than $30 billion to Charles Schwab. Come see why.
Introducing the Saturn Ion, specifically designed and engineered for whatever's next.
When you run a restaurant, no matter what's on the menu, you're only serving one thing, taste. And if you can get great taste without the extra sugar, that's the best. That's why I use Equal. There's no aftertaste like with some sweeteners. You like rich, creamy cheesecake? I do. I make it at home, too, and not with a half pound of sugar. I use Equal. Mocha Swirl. Great taste without the extra sugar. I love it. Zero calorie Equal. Have you tried it lately?
This week, history was made in the nation's capital as Dr. Senator Bill Frist took over leadership in the Senate. And the only interview the new majority leader granted on this historic morning was to Diane Sawyer and Good Morning America. When it's important, timely, exclusive, it's Good Morning America leading the way.
In this week's briefing book, one Republican's trial balloon on race falls flat on Capitol Hill. Last month, Kansas Senator Sam Brownback proposed a plan to calm the Trent Lott controversy.
So I'm hoping we can have a select committee within the Senate, maybe even bipartisan, bicameral with the House and the Senate, to really focus on the issue of race relations, specifically what can we do to pull together as a nation and be one nation on race relations.
But when the Republican conference met behind closed doors earlier this week, Brownback's plan was quickly killed. Several of his colleagues were certain the committee would become a club for beating up Republicans on the race issue. A source close to Brownback confirmed the committee idea is dead and said that the senator would now focus on working with Democrat John Lewis to build a museum of African American history on the Mall in Washington. For his part, Republican leader Bill Frist begins his efforts to put the Lott story to rest this week. Tomorrow, he meets with black leaders at the RNC, followed by a speech to commemorate Martin Luther King Day. Thanks for sharing part of your Sunday with us. Until next week, that's This Week.
Every time I travel.
Wait if your email and can't move on this till we hear from you.
Thanks.
This message is high priority.
Backed up emails.
Regarding annual reporting.
Hi, honey. Good luck today.
Here. When your company has PCS Vision from Sprint, you're always logged on, so you can exchange emails like on your computer instantly.
Hey, yeah. Remember to turn in that report, because
I'm all caught up.
And cleared up.
PCS Vision from Sprint, now available with unlimited email for your business.
CIT.
One place, when the Republicans finally broke ranks and went on the record about a change in their leadership. One place, when Time Magazine chose its Persons of the Year, three fearless whistleblowers spoke here first. One place, when just days after announcing his bid for the White House, John Edwards granted his only in-depth exclusive interview. One place. This is The Place. This week with George Stephanopoulos. It's where news is made every Sunday.
Units of blood in a six-month period. If there's a new war, experts say there may not be enough blood. ABC's Lisa Sylvester explains.
Next, please.
Private Tyler Smith, who is currently stationed at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, may not be sent overseas, but there is a good chance his blood will go.
I think if you're healthy, you should give blood because it's the right thing to do.
The blood center here needs to collect about 700 units of blood a month. It has collected only 200 units this month. Military installations across the country have been scrambling to collect more blood. Since the campaign in Afghanistan began, the military has sent about 17,000 units of blood to the region. If there is a war with Iraq, the demand could be more than 10 times that amount.
But as the demand has increased, those in the military able to give blood has fallen. 43% of all servicemen and women are ineligible to donate.
Concerns about exposure to mad cow disease have disqualified soldiers and their families stationed in Europe between 1980 and 1996. The fear of malaria prevents military personnel deployed to certain countries, including Afghanistan, from giving blood for 3 years. And anyone who receives the smallpox vaccine will have to wait a month before giving blood.
We rely on the civilians in case we don't have enough. So it's not only the military blood program, but it's the civilian collection agencies that need donors at this time.
Blood is perishable, and blood centers need a constant supply. The key is not just getting people in the door, but getting the right people. Lisa Sylvester, ABC News, The Pentagon.
Next, World War II vets rally around one of their own. Finally tonight, a story of courage and cartoons. This is the story of Bill Mauldin, the Pulitzer Prize winning cartoonist who now has Alzheimer's disease. He kept the troops going in World War II with his cartoons in the Army newspaper, Stars and Stripes. Now they are paying him back. Here's ABC's Ned Potter.
Dear Bill, I was an infantryman with the 45th Division, 7th Army. Dear Bill, I remember talking to you in a foxhole. Dear Bill, I think of you as not only a fellow soldier, but as an intimate friend.
This is the Dear Bill all those GIs remember, the baby-faced infantryman who created Willie and Joe. Bill Mauldin's comics of two bedraggled soldiers made him perhaps the most loved cartoonist of World War II.
He really spoke for those guys, and he made sure that they understood that we know what you're going through.
Hi, Dad. Hi, it's Nat.
Now, Mauldin's son Nat goes to visit him in a California nursing home. He's 81 and fighting Alzheimer's. But an army of well-wishers is sending him reinforcements. 10,000 letters so far and counting.
We who endured the life that you depicted are disappearing one by one. But Willie and Joe will live forever.
Mauldin won the first of two Pulitzers in 1945 when he was only 23 years old. General George Patton considered Mauldin disrespectful, but the men loved it when he drew a sergeant, sadly putting his Jeep out of its misery.
When you start laughing at machine gun bullets going between a guy's legs, you're pretty desperate for humor.
Jay Gruenfeld is a veteran himself. And when he heard Mauldin was ill, he rallied the troops, using VFW halls and newspapers to start the letter-writing campaign.
If we hadn't had his cartoons, you would have had a lot more battle fatigue, neurosis cases, with kids just breaking down.
Just a dozen years ago, Mulden was still at it, drawing the soldiers masked for the Gulf War.
You sketched my dad someplace in Italy.
I did.
I got my mom's got the photo. I remember them showing it to me when I was little.
We can only imagine what he would do for today's troops if he could. Yeah. Instead, generations are writing to him. Their letters paper the walls of his room, and Nat Mulden says his father deserves to hear them.
They're impossible to ignore. He has to hear them. They have to be read. I thank God each day for granting us a war companion who gave us perspectives on our dedicated rounds, and I beseech him to keep you in good health and good spirits. Willie and Joe are immortal, as you are in our memories.
Countless veterans say Mulden's pictures kept them going. Now they hope their words will do the same for him. Ned Potter, ABC News, New York.
And that's our report. I'm Carol Simpson.
Good. Ready to serve, reluctant to kill.
That is kind of eager for combat.
No, sir. I mean, there's nothing good about taking a human life. But in the event that you have to do it, then you better be prepared to do it.
The Baghdad professor, ready to fight back.
I would rather be dead and buried than see American troops occupying my country.
And the Israeli mother, plagued by ghosts of the Gulf War.
What one missile can do, it's something you cannot imagine.
Also, praying for peace. She lost her brother on September 11th, but now works against the war.
I don't want to have hate and revenge fill my heart.
As soldiers and civilians prepare for the worst, it is painful to contemplate. Some have dreams.
If we put a stop to Saddam now, maybe we could have Iraq back to how it used to be.
While others have determination.
The president always said, in order to protect the American people, protect our interests in the world, he will take unilateral action to take out Saddam Hussein.
Tonight, from coast to coast and around the world, Tom Brokaw reports, The Road to Baghdad, after these brief messages.
What happened?
I ordered 200 oxen, but they sent us all these little wiener dogs.
200 dachshund. Are you on a cell phone, sir?
Well, yeah.
Static. Here, now you can get clear calls and do more, because Sprint built the largest all-digital, all-PCS-enhanced nationwide network from the ground up. For clarity, you can see and hear.
Thanks. Now, this would have helped.
For $30 a month, get unlimited PCS Vision 300 anytime and unlimited night and weekend minutes from Sprint.
To me, comfort food is Olive Garden's hot, homemade pasta fagioli soup. They make it with fresh everything. And you can get all you want with their unlimited soup, salad, and breadsticks lunch. I feel warm all over just talking about it. Olive Garden, when you're here, you're family.
Magnificent.
We took the taste of raisin cinnamon bread for Quaker Raisin Cinnamon Swirl Oatmeal. So good, you'll wonder where we got the recipe.
Introducing the new Nissan Murano for your adventures in on-roading.
Denzel, Nicole, George, Hallie, Leonardo, Al, Julia, Tom, Brad, Harris, Cameron, Steve, Jim, Tom, Russ, Jennifer, James, Aaron, Matthew, Mark, Benjamin, Steve, Deborah, Jay, Angela, Will, Jack.
I want to thank my fellow nominees.
Live and unpredictable.
She's under the table.
It's the party of the year.
I love it.
The Golden Globe Awards next Sunday on NBC.
On the next all-new Law & Order Criminal Intent, Sunday's number one show, a woman caught in a web with four men is found murdered.
You have my attention.
Three of them hated her. One wanted her dead.
She trusted you.
It all leads to a bizarre ending.
You punished her!
All-new Law & Order Criminal Intent, NBC Tonight.
And now, The Road to Baghdad, reported by Tom Brokaw.
Good evening from Baghdad, the capital of Iraq, the home of Saddam Hussein, the man and the country that have American military forces combat ready and their commander-in-chief prepared to send them into battle. How did it come to this? After all the warnings and threats, the debate and diplomacy, the power plays from President Bush at the White House to Colin Powell at the United Nations, from NATO to Moscow to the Middle East and beyond.
Tune, our tune, tune.
From the soldier preparing to fight this war to the activist committed to preventing it, from the Iraqi family bracing for bombs to fall to the Israeli living in fear of a counteroffensive. The prospect of war for them is not just another headline. It is through their lives, hopes, and fears that the rest of us may begin to better understand what could happen here.
Attention!
Warriors!
It is November 2002, and Army Staff Sergeant Charles Weaver is preparing for war. Before the month is up, he could be heading for the deserts of Kuwait, the primary staging ground for any military action against Iraq.
Nobody wants to go to war. Nobody. But if you have to do it, you do whatever you have to do.
Parade!
When there's talk of casualties, of the American men and women who could lose their lives in a war with Saddam Hussein, they're talking about 31-year-old Weaver, family man, third-generation military, duty-bound to obey whatever order is handed down by his commander-in-chief, George W. Bush.
Do you talk about the possibility of war?
Yes.
I mean, we do. Make the plans. Like, we were just talking about how I got to go update my will, stuff like that, just in case.
You do. You hope for the best, but you have to prepare for the worst.
When I spoke with Weaver, he was waiting for a call, letting him know that it was time to ship out, a call that could come any day. Technically, it will be a routine deployment. But ever since the 9/11 terrorist attacks and the war on terror that followed, Weaver and his wife Dawn say they've been on alert.
When 9/11 happened, did you think to yourself that day, my life has really changed?
Yes, because I was highly concerned that my husband was getting ready to go somewhere.
The family has been through this drill before. Since Weaver has been married, he has missed every other Thanksgiving and Christmas. When his first child, Christina, was born, he was 7,000 miles away in Korea, and he missed her birth as well. Today, Christina is 5, old enough to understand that her dad may be going away for a very long time.
I want to know if you'll get to call us and talk to us on the phone.
Okay. Depends on what's going on, Christina. Your daddy might be in the field a lot, might be doing other things, but I'll write you guys a lot, okay?
Nobody wants to leave their wife at home. Nobody wants to leave their kids, and I honestly believe that. You don't help them if you get all emotional and teary-eyed.
You gotta stay focused on the mission.
Exactly. Stay focused on your mission, stay focused on your soldiers, and that way you bring everybody back.
Number 42.
If Weaver is called upon to fight, it will be a war that has been developing for 4 months. Last fall at the United Nations, President Bush put Saddam Hussein in the crosshairs, accusing him of secretly developing and hiding weapons of mass destruction, of working with terrorists connected to Osama bin Laden.
Saddam Hussein's regime is a grave and gathering danger.
And on November 8th, the U.S. convinced the United Nations to issue Saddam an ultimatum, allow weapons inspectors back into Iraq and disarm, or prepare for military action. It was the first step in a process that could have sweeping consequences for men such as Staff Sergeant Weaver and so many others who would find themselves carried along on the road to Baghdad. Life in Baghdad, always chaotic, but surprisingly calm in the days following the passage of the UN resolution. But then after all, these are people who have been bombed before. But this time, if war comes to Iraq, it will be much different. This will be a war to remove Saddam Hussein from power, to install a new government. This will be a war that will come directly into the lives and the homes of these people. In Baghdad, Saddam's government thinks of Mohammed el-Rubai, a father and former soldier, professor of history at a Baghdad university, as a typical citizen.
Hakim Omar, let me...
Professor Mohammed's job is prestigious, but he's hardly wealthy. With an income of only $50 a month, he and his wife, Lubna, earn enough to rent this modest four-room apartment and buy the occasional pair of blue jeans for their three children. When I met them in November, the family didn't seem overly concerned about the possibility of war.
Ludma, in your neighborhood, in your community, what do the women say to each other about what is going on now?
As human beings, we can't discuss war every day. We have become used to this situation. We're not frightened.
After all, Iraq has been at war almost constantly for more than a quarter of a century. Saddam's 8-year war with Iran took more than 300,000 Iraqi lives in the 1980s. In 1990, Saddam invaded Kuwait, triggering the Gulf War. The United States and its allies did most of their fighting in western Iraq, but there were intense bomb and missile raids on Baghdad aimed at military and political targets. But hundreds, perhaps thousands of civilians were killed.
Why the war? Why? For what?
By mid-November, the chance of a new war seemed to be growing every day.
We're through negotiations, there's no more time. It is, the man must disarm.
Finally, on November 13th, Saddam agreed to weapons inspections. But the Iraqi response also lashed out at the United States, accusing it of wicked slander and malicious intent. A defiance that Mohammed said he welcomed. Like many in the Arab world, he believes that President Bush has hidden motives for waging war. American imperialism, our alliance with Israel, and above all, seizing Iraq's rich oil reserves, the second largest in the world.
President Bush says this is not about oil. He says it's about the dangers that Saddam Hussein represents to the world.
Has Iraq threatened the property of the United States? Has Iraq taken to the seas to wage war against the United States? War is not a game. The United States has no right to attack us.
Many of the other people I spoke with in Baghdad agreed with Professor Mohammed that they support Saddam and want him to remain in power. But keep in mind that a government official was with us at every interview, and the penalty for criticizing Saddam can be lengthy imprisonment or worse. Miles away, those who have fled the country and are now safely outside of Iraq have a very different story to tell. Iraqi exiles Abbas, Sabria, and Ezra Nama say they're very lucky to have survived Saddam's murderous ways.
Do you still have nightmares, bad dreams about that time?
Yes. My mom, I believe she did not sleep for maybe 40 days every night thinking that one day they're gonna come and take one of her children. They're gonna slaughter them in front of her.
The Namas are Shiite Muslims who lived in the south of Iraq where the father had a prosperous chain of pharmacies until the Gulf War. When the war was over and the first President Bush encouraged Iraqis to rise up against Saddam, Abbas, who had been pressed into the Iraqi military, was eager to do just that.
So did you think you were going to succeed? Did you think you were gonna be able to throw over Saddam Hussein?
Yes, actually, when the chance came, the people actually revolt against Saddam.
They were poorly organized and barely armed, but they seized control of most of southern Iraq. Then they waited for U.S. support. But when America refused to get involved, Saddam turned on the Iraqi dissidents with a blood rage. Thousands were slaughtered. Abbas feared that his family would be next.
I remember my father came home and told my mom to take all of us and go away to some farm, to some village, and hide.
And you can move, what, only at night?
We were able to move only at night. And at some farms where we got to, we saw some people being taken and slaughtered. I remember seeing two guys hung on palm trees.
After a harrowing escape across the border, they made it to Saudi Arabia, and after nearly 2 years in a refugee camp, to America.
Tell me about what it was like to come to America.
It was like being born all over again. It gave us a new life, a new beginning. America has fulfilled our dreams.
Today, they have dreams of freedom for other Iraqi citizens. Abbas is now a successful pharmacist here. The Namas, who are part of a thriving Iraqi community in San Diego,
have spent much of the fall pushing for war, holding exile meetings, talking to State Department officials, even coaching U.S. Marines on fighting conditions outside of Baghdad. They want to see the United States finish the job it began in 1991, when it won the war but left Saddam in power. For them, the war brings personal risk. They still have family members in southern Iraq. Still, they believe force is the only way to end Saddam's brutal rule.
He is dangerous against his people, against his neighbor, the region, the world.
On November 16th, the outcome of the showdown between President Bush and Saddam Hussein remained uncertain as weapons inspectors prepared to land in Iraq for the first time in 4 years. What would inspectors find? Would it be enough to trigger a war?
So, set up a department meeting for tomorrow and put in a call to the client, get them up to speed. Anything else?
Here's a thought. Instead of saving money by not using paper, we could just go to Staples.
Yeah, with Staples 365 Savings, they compare prices and back it up with 110% price match guarantee.
I like that. Jot that down.
Low prices on every item every day. Staples 365 Savings. Savings made easy.
Yo! Yes, you're excited.
Ooh.
I know what you're thinking. You're thinking Beneful.
You've never seen anything like it before. It has wholesome grains, real beef, even carrots and peas. So there's carbohydrates for energy and protein for the serious muscles.
And you even get some vegetables.
So happy.
You love it so much you only think you're getting spoiled.
Yes, you do. But it's good for you, too.
Healthful, flavorful, Beneful. Beneful brand by Purina.
That's my little brother, Patrick. He's very annoying. He follows me almost everywhere and makes way too much noise. Fortunately, he's sick today. Thank you.
Nothing works faster on fever than children's Tylenol. No wonder it's still the pediatrician's number one choice.
Sorry, honey. I had to give it to him.
Children's Tylenol. For fast fever relief.
We all fall in love. And we all get colds. Hopefully not on the same day. Thank goodness for Kleenex tissues. Ultra soft, 3-germ blocking layers help you share feelings, not germs.
I usually break it into pieces. That way, you know, you trick your mind into thinking there's more than there actually is. It's a good feeling. It's like, like getting a big hug from somebody you haven't seen in a long time. That's what Hershey feels like to me.
I love everything about fresh-squeezed orange juice, except the squeezing part. So I pour myself some Tropicana Pure Premium instead. Tropicana gets its fresh-squeezed taste from one thing, oranges. It's never from concentrate. It's nothing but juice. So I get the great taste I love without getting orange peel under my fingernails.
So pure, so alive, Tropicana.
My hair was totally fried. Infusium made a difference like that.
Infusium 23 leave-in treatment. The leave-in Beth believes in.
I can finally comb through this hair when it's wet.
It's the leave-in Shari believes in. Infusium 23 leave-in treatment corrects, restores, and structurizes damaged hair. After one use, hair looks healthier.
I believe that it has saved my hair. Infusium is like a miracle.
Infusium 23, the leave-in you'll believe in. Something else to believe in. Infusium shampoos and conditioners. You'll love them.
It's hard to lose your best friend, especially when it's your son. To go from being the hero to the villain, I've become the snoop, the spy. I pry into his life. He says, I'll never treat my son like this. And I think, if you love him, you will.
We now continue with The Road to Baghdad, reported by Tom Brokaw.
This is what nerve gas can do. These pictures are from Saddam Hussein's 1988 attack on Iraq's Kurdish minority. Proof of his cold-blooded and inhumane behavior, would he do it again? President Bush believes the answer is yes. On November 18th, United Nations inspectors arrived in Baghdad. The president had warned any cover-up would trigger war.
We will not tolerate any deception, denial, or deceit.
Strong words that echoed from the bazaars of Baghdad to the shooting ranges of American Army bases.
You want it on the edge right here, up right here like this, babe?
In Georgia, Staff Sergeant Charles Weaver was at home, stringing the Christmas lights early, knowing he'd probably spend one more holiday away from his family.
How'd school go?
Good, bye.
What'd you do? What'd you learn?
Any day, the phone could ring with a call from the Army, ordering him to deploy to the Middle East. Like the rest of us, he had no idea how this showdown would play out.
A lot of people think you got a direct line to the White House, and you have to tell them, I don't know, I can't tell you, I don't know what's gonna happen.
You're down at the end of the chain, right?
Yeah, exactly, I'm the last little morsel on the food chain.
Weaver believes the president is right. Saddam must disarm, or else. But his role in this drama is to carry out what the commander-in-chief decides.
We're the United States military. And whether people support us or not, that's what we have to do.
In polls, most Americans say they are in favor of war with Iraq, but they also say they don't want the U.S. to act alone. They want it to be an international effort. But that support isn't universal.
There can be peaceful resolution.
New Yorker Colleen Kelly is part of a small but growing coalition of Americans opposed to military action in Iraq. A vocal minority that is asking, why now? Why this war?
I think that the public deserves this very, very public and open debate about this issue.
As President Bush was pressuring France, Russia, and other NATO nations to support U.S. policy in Iraq,
we set a tone for the vigil.
Colleen was working the phones, speaking at small gatherings, trying to convince anyone who would listen that the war against Iraq is wrong. She is an unlikely activist. For her, the campaign is a personal mission in honor of her brother Bill, who died in the September 11th terrorist attacks. By day, Bill sold stock trading computers. But away from the office, he was a high-spirited adventurer who doted on his nieces and nephews.
Bill would arrive at my parents' house and nine kids would go screaming out the door, Uncle Billy's here, Uncle Billy's here.
After the World Trade Center attack, Colleen's 8-year-old son drew this picture of an angel lifting his uncle to heaven as the towers burned.
There was a part of me that was very, very angry and hurt about my brother's death. And then this other emotion, just thinking about that hurt and not wanting anyone else to experience that.
September 11th changed lives around the globe. For President Bush, it was a rallying cry for war. First in Afghanistan, and now Iraq. But for Colleen, it became a call to a different kind of action. Colleen, a nurse practitioner, helped found a group called September 11th Families for Peaceful Tomorrows. They advocate nonviolence.
Less than a year after 9/11, the president began talking about the possible need to go to war against Iraq. What was your reaction?
I began to worry very much. I felt like the country's whole focus was being diverted to a whole nother issue when we hadn't even finished with problem number one yet.
Colleen worries that the war on terror will suffer if the United States wages war on Baghdad. She's convinced that military action will create more problems than it solves.
How do you respond to those people who say, look, Saddam Hussein has gassed his own people, he's invaded Kuwait, it's just a matter of time before he launches against us. We think he's a dangerous man.
I agree that he's a dangerous man, but is there a way of getting him out of power without killing other people?
If it comes to war with Iraq, what worries you the most?
What worries me the most is that it's not going to be contained to just Iraq, that Israel will become involved, that Saudi Arabia will become involved, that this will mushroom, that this will spread, that this could be the beginning of World War III.
In 1991, the Gulf War did spread beyond Iraq when Saddam launched 39 missiles at Israel. Many in the Middle East share the fear that another war will further inflame the already tense region. When I visited Tel Aviv on November 25th, the Israeli government was stepping up preparations for war, distributing gas masks, conducting weapons drills, positioning new missile defense shields. Israeli Smadar Weinberg was watching each move closely, terrified that history might repeat itself. Smadar, an attorney, is the mother of five children and another victim of Saddam Hussein. In 1991, her 51-year-old father was home alone when one of Saddam's missiles ripped through his house and killed him.
What one missile can do, it's something you cannot imagine.
There's all this talk about war and the possibility of Israel coming under attack again. Bring back painful memories for you?
When they are talking about war, when you see Saddam Hussein on TV and his lies, you think about it.
On the eve of UN inspections, Smadar was thinking about what happened to her father, but also what might happen to her children if Saddam attacks again. Smadar would soon face a difficult choice: remain in Israel, vulnerable to Iraqi attack, or leave her homeland. ...550 miles away in Baghdad, November 27th marked day one of the inspections and a critical turning point in the escalating crisis. Inspectors had 60 days to search for weapons that could be hidden almost anywhere in a country the size of California. The United States said it was up to Saddam to prove he had no such weapons or face an invasion aimed at the heart of his regime, one that could bring American soldiers to the streets of Baghdad. If and when American warriors come into Baghdad, many of the Iraqis that we've talked to say they are prepared to fight them block by block in neighborhoods like this. President Bush and his advisors don't believe that. They believe that the Iraqi people will be so relieved to be rid of Saddam Hussein, there will be dancing in the streets. The fact is, it's impossible to know exactly what will happen. Professor Mohammed said he is ready to fight for Saddam.
Some advisors to President Bush believe that if there is war and Saddam Hussein is toppled from power, that there will be great celebrations in Baghdad. Do you agree with that?
The Iraqi people will offer their own blood for Saddam Hussein. They want Saddam to remain in power.
Would you be prepared to go back in the army if there were a war?
I'm prepared to defend my country at any time. I talk with my students and I stress it's their duty to defend their nation.
I heard Mohammed's statements echoed throughout the streets and storefronts of Baghdad. Again, it's important to remember that in Saddam's Iraq, this has to be the party line. Other Iraqis quietly confided to me the Americans would be welcome, but they could not say so publicly for fear of punishment or death. As for Staff Sergeant Weaver, he could find himself on the front lines wherever the fighting occurs. Although Weaver's been in the military for 14 years, he's never been in combat.
Do you think about it much?
I always pray, please God, don't let me screw this up.
Is there a small part of you that is kind of eager for combat after all these years of training?
No, sir.
No part of it?
No, sir. I mean, honestly, I mean, it's great to be able to go out there and battle test yourself and all that, but that's the last thing I want to do.
You don't want people shooting back at you?
I don't want to shoot at them either. I mean, there's nothing good about taking a human life. But in the event that you have to do it, then you better be prepared to do it.
All over the world, forces were in motion. Lives were at risk. As UN inspectors continue to look for weapons in Iraq, with the clock ticking down to a deadline for confrontation.
NBC Tonight, Boomtown is all new. Someone pulled off the perfect crime.
We need to find your husband's murderer.
In front of you is every clue. A hunt, a cover-up, a Boomtown twist.
I'm chasing a ghost.
The clock is set. Ah! Can you find the killer before they do? An all-new Boomtown, NBC Tonight.
This Monday, CBS has all repeats, but NBC Monday is all new. Starting at 8, 7 Central, with the first of 10 all-new Fear Factors in a row. Then, an all-new Third Watch.
But you all actually believe that I did it?
A paramedic accused of the worst. Then, all-new Crossing Jordan.
Holy!
Who killed Mom? This baby holds the key. Only one problem.
The baby's been snatched.
Fear Factor, Third Watch, and Crossing Jordan. All-new NBC Monday.
Number 14, an available 32-valve iForce V8 engine. Number 21, available downhill assist control. Number 77, available X-Rear Sport Enhancement Suspension. Number 8, hill start assist control. Number 60, a larger, more comfortable interior. The all-new 2003 4Runner has been completely redesigned with nearly 100 new advancements and changes. It's larger, more powerful, and more capable.
Bertoli!
Why go out for great Italian? Introducing Bertoli frozen dinners. Savor plump shrimp scampi and linguine al dente, served with roasted red peppers, all in a luscious garlic sauce inspired by Italy's top chefs. Just sauté and serve. Now you don't have to be an Italian chef.
Bertoli!
To be an Italian chef. New Bertoli frozen dinners. Italian for great food.
Peter, you considered my offer? I'll give you power.
I've got power.
I'll give you riches.
Riches? I've got riches.
All right, I'll leave it.
Now you can have luxury without selling your soul. The 2003 Camry, the most irresistible Camry we've ever built.
Will Senator Lieberman run for president? His decision, Monday at 5.
The road to Baghdad continues.
December 7th marked the most critical day yet in the showdown with Iraq. As weapons inspectors scoured the country, Saddam Hussein handed over a 12,000-page declaration claiming that all chemical, biological, or nuclear materials had been destroyed. The next move was up to the United States, and President Bush continued to insist that if the U.S. found any lies or omissions in Saddam's document, that could be a material breach of the U.N. resolution, grounds for war.
That declaration must be credible and complete, or the Iraqi dictator will have demonstrated to the world once again that he has chosen not to change his behavior.
By now, there were more than 60,000 U.S. troops within striking distance of Iraq, and more soldiers arriving each day. At Fort Stewart, Georgia, Staff Sergeant Weaver had spent much of the fall preparing his troops for the long march to Baghdad.
Do you have a power of attorney? You guys both got wills?
As leader of his platoon, Weaver is the chief role model for these young warriors, many in their teens who have never been to a foreign country.
When there began to be talk about a war against Iraq, did you think a lot more about this is for real, this is not just a training mission anymore?
I didn't join the military to sit at home, and I knew the possibility of going to war is an everyday event for me. But I think it helped some of my soldiers realize that this is a real possibility.
Weaver's outfit here at Fort Stewart is expert in mechanized warfare, moving swiftly across the desert to engage the enemy with a lot of firepower. But this time, if there is war with Iraq, there's a lot of concern about chemical and biological warfare.
This is to detect what kind of spray you've been sprayed with. If it turns a yellow color, it's a nerve agent.
In this drill, Weaver and his men train with tear gas, learning how to function if attacked with chemical weapons.
He's used them against women and children. What makes anybody in their right mind think that he wouldn't try to use them against us?
The stakes couldn't be higher. A single drop of VX nerve agent on any part of the body can kill. But Staff Sergeant Weaver says he is confident his equipment and his training will be good enough. And if it comes to war in Iraq, they'll have to be. This is a middle-class neighborhood in Baghdad, and the people who live here have been through American bombings before. Now, with the talk of war coming again, They're making some preparations, but mostly they're just trying to get on with their lives day by day.
If the United States bombs Iraq, UN officials predict that as many as 10 million can find themselves without power, clean water, or food. But at his home in Baghdad, Mohammed al-Rubai said that God would protect him from bombs. The past U.S. attacks and 12 years of harsh economic sanctions imposed after the Gulf War had prepared his family for any hardship.
If there is another war, will you stay here?
No, yes, I'll stay. And the children will stay, too.
When I visited Baghdad, Professor Mohammed showed me a small generator that could power electric lights for his family and a few neighbors. And he had about 10 of these kerosene lamps. If their water supply is cut off by bombs, he said they'll boil dirty water from the River Tigris to drink. Desperate measures, unthinkable in the United States, even after September 11th. In New York, anti-war activist Colleen Kelly spent December warning about the dangers to families like Mohammed's, families who might fall victim to violence, and who reminded her of her brother.
My brother Bill was killed at the World Trade Center. He didn't work there. He just happened to be there at the wrong place at the wrong time.
In early December, Kelly's group took part in a day of action. Demonstrators marched on the UN, the White House, and military recruitment centers. It was the first national protest in almost 2 months, but the event drew little public attention. Colleen admitted that at times she was fighting a lonely battle.
I spoke down at the University of Pennsylvania, and six people came to that talk. Two of them were my parents.
As war talk intensified, Colleen and her group became determined to do something that would grab headlines and make Americans reflect on the human cost of war. They began planning a trip to Iraq.
What do you think you can accomplish?
If there's a war in Iraq, there will be innocent families who will also be affected. And I want to put a human face on those families.
There are going to be those who are going to say that's naive. Iraq is run by Saddam Hussein, not by the people from the
you're
ground.
You're absolutely right. I'm not purporting to be this expert about that, but I am an expert in losing someone that I love. I feel that I can't be any further from naive. My brother was murdered, and I know the consequences.
Abbas Nama's brother was also murdered by Saddam Hussein's security forces. He and his family fled Iraq with just the clothes on their back. Today, they have a quintessential American life. Most of the kids have graduated college, two have married. 17-year-old Mahmoud is a diehard Chargers fan. They are American citizens now, but still, their primary concern is Iraq. On December 14th, they watched on television as some 50 diverse opposition groups came together at a conference in London to lay the foundation for an Iraqi government after Saddam Hussein.
If we put a stop to Saddam now, maybe we could have Iraq back to how it used to be.
Ezra, do you talk in your family a lot about going back to Iraq?
I would love to go visit, but not to live. My mom and my father would love to go back.
You want to go back?
I'm dreaming.
Dreaming of a place, she says, where prosperity, freedom, and democracy all are possible. In mid-December, the prospect of war intensified as reports surfaced that Saddam Hussein had deployed new surface-to-surface missiles capable of launching chemical or biological weapons on U.S. troops and allies in the Middle East. U.S. officials responded that if such an attack occurred, the U.S. would not rule out a nuclear attack on Baghdad. And on December 19th, Secretary of State Colin Powell released the United States verdict on Saddam Hussein's weapons declaration, calling it, in no uncertain terms, a lie. Saddam, it said, had failed to account for 4 tons of nerve agents, 2 tons of biological materials, including anthrax, and its design for a nuclear weapon.
These are material omissions that, in our view, constitute another material breach. We are disappointed, but we are not deceived.
It was the strongest signal yet that the United States was ready to go to war. And in Fort Stewart, the reality of what that war could bring to a family already was affecting the Weavers.
Do you ever allow yourself to think, God, I might get hurt, or I may not come back?
Of course.
You think about that, Don?
I think about him dying. I think about him dying all the time. He just doesn't know it, and I just don't talk to him about it. Sometimes I start crying in the car, just over the fact of, okay, you know, this is the man I plan on spending the rest of my life with. What happens if I do lose him? What am I going to do? How am I going to mentally prepare myself? And how am I going to explain that to my kids?
Hard to talk about it even now, right?
Yeah.
You'll be all right, Sarge.
I know. I always am.
All right, no tears, Dawn.
Unfortunately, it comes with the territory, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
On December 20th, just 8 miles from Iraq, the Army staged its largest combat training exercise since the Gulf War. The move was intended to send a strong message to Saddam: surrender before the fighting begins. But one day later, the Iraqi leader unleashed a defiant attack on President Bush, calling him a bloodthirsty leader who was beating the drums of war. And on Christmas Eve, as much of the world celebrated the Christian holiday of peace, Iraqis, he warned, were ready to rise up and fight.
They call this art?
I tell you what I call it, brother.
It symbolizes my frustration of committing to a phone plan I don't always need.
You should be dialing 1010-220, little dude.
Yeah, it's a great phone service with no monthly commitment.
With 1010-220, all calls up to 20 minutes are 99 cents.
It's cheap, whether you use it a little or a lot.
That is a great deal.
Now, this speaks to me.
It says cheap.
Dial 1010-220.
Brother!
Whenever I know I'm going to meet someone, I always do this. Just to see if I need a Tic Tac. Friendly little 1.5 calorie bread thins.
Tic Tac. For a refreshing twist, try Tic Tac Lime.
If you could use the anti-wrinkle cream that was #1 dermatologist recommended, that had the #1 wrinkle fighter retinol, and was the #1 selling anti-wrinkle cream, would you use it?
I would.
Neutrogena Healthy Skin Anti-Wrinkle Cream.
Using HP mobile technology to get information quickly and easily, the world's police forces now fight crime digitally.
Monday, go behind the scenes of Cirque du Soleil Fire Within. Then, 9 actors try to make It, the world premiere of It Factor Los Angeles. Bravo Reality Monday.
Monday, violent protests, the threat of war. It all means filling your tank will empty your wallet. What you should know, NBC Nightly News Monday.
How likely is a war with Iraq? How would it be fought? At what cost? To learn more, visit our website at msnbc.com.
Dateline Tuesday, amazing stories. The Raelians. A follower claims to have cloned a human, and they say that we're all created by aliens. Plus, the Guatemalan twins. After their successful separation, they finally go home. And missing. A young pregnant woman vanished since Christmas Eve. The search continues. Amazing stories. Dateline Tuesday, 10, 9 central on NBC.
A cop's search for a killer could lead to his wife.
Something happened the night that Colin was murdered.
And his son.
I did something wrong.
Murder at Midnight, Days of Our Lives.
When he came home, the workday done, the weekend chores had just begun.
Eddie.
So he packed up his wife and his #1 son.
And headed out for coffee and a sticky.
Fun. Singing hi, hi, ho. And his name was Eddie Blodgett. Singing hi, hi, hee. He's a software engineer, so off they go a-riding to discover and explore on the trail to the warehouse store.
Ready?
Yeah!
Where are they going?
Oh, never-ending pancakes down at IHOP.
Right now at IHOP, it's never-ending pancakes. Order a 5-stack of the buttermilk pancakes you love, and we'll be happy to keep them coming. All for only $3.99 every day. IHOP, come hungry, leave happy.
Kaud Brothers Oriental Rugs, January clearance sale. Our first big sale of the year.
It's not just our first big sale of the year. It's the biggest sale in our history.
Come in now.
Kaud Oriental Rugs, West Hartford, Connecticut, and Holyoke, Mass.
And don't forget to ask for me, 10% Charlie.
At Nissan, we were brainstorming about the Sentra, and everyone had something to add. A more powerful engine, automatic transmission, anti-lock brakes, 15-inch alloy wheels, a 180-watt 7-speaker stereo. The result? The new limited edition Sentra. Unlimited possibilities with 2.9 financing for 60 months and 1,000 cash back. Available at your Nissan dealer now.
Pinpoint 30 Storm Alert, on air and online.
We now return to The Road to Baghdad.
As Americans rang in the new year, in Iraq, weapons inspectors spent the holiday on the job, scouring the country for weapons of mass destruction. 2 weeks from tomorrow, they are scheduled to submit their preliminary findings to the UN, a report that could be a trigger for war. The stakes are high, here at home, in Iraq, and around the world. In the Middle East, Smadar Weinberg was bracing herself for what could come next.
War is getting closer, and I'm just trying to prepare myself and my children.
In 1991, an Iraqi Scud missile killed Smadar's father. This time, if war seems imminent, Smadar isn't taking any chances. She and her family have decided to leave Israel. Smadar spent much of December preparing for that day, getting her passport in order, even buying an apartment in Cyprus. Still, she knows she won't be able to protect everyone in her family. Smadar's 18-year-old daughter just reported for duty in the Israeli Air Force. If Smadar evacuates, her daughter will have to stay behind, vulnerable to any attack.
I believe you're really going.
Neither can I read it.
In New York, anti-war activist Colleen Kelly was still hoping there would be no attacks anywhere. 1 week ago, she and other members of her group embarked on a trip to Iraq. They packed supplies like medicine and toys, but mostly, they hoped the trip would bring attention to the human face of war. 2 days later, Colleen was on the ground in Baghdad touring a bomb shelter where civilians had been killed during the Gulf War.
With the Iraqi families, but
Colleen's visit is risky. She could be used as a tool in Saddam's propaganda war against the West, but she insists that she is in Iraq as a patriot.
I think this is one of the most patriotic things that I could do, is to come to this country and hope for peace and hope for a diplomatic solution to this.
Colleen says that she knows other 9/11 families may not agree, but for her, this is the right way to remember her brother.
My brother was murdered. That is the reality for me. And I know. And I don't want to have hate and revenge fill my heart.
That same weekend in San Diego, the entire Nama family turned out to plan for democracy in a post-Saddam Iraq, a topic that has taken on a new urgency in recent weeks.
We are looking to the day of liberation of Iraq.
Do you think there will be war?
Definitely it's war.
If it comes to that, and Saddam is removed, 22-year-old Ezra says she too will return to Iraq. She's had a change of heart since we first met her in November.
I used to say, well, I'll go back to visit. And I've been thinking lately that if we, the new generation, don't go back to Iraq and rebuild our country, who's going to go back and rebuild our country?
January 6th marked Army Day in Iraq. And Saddam Hussein took the opportunity to prepare his people for a showdown with President Bush. In Baghdad, the city was on edge. Even Professor Mohammed's family, who appeared so calm 2 months earlier, was now making preparations for war.
For sure, I feel worried because of the children.
I do feel worried about the war, and now I've made many preparations for a war that I think is coming soon.
They built a clay oven in their backyard so Lubna could cook without oil. And last week, they began stockpiling rice, flour, and sugar, so they'll have enough to eat if rations are cut off. But whatever happens, they insist they'll still stand by Saddam.
If foreigners come into our homes, we won't stand by and do nothing.
I would rather be dead and buried than see American troops occupying my country.
On January 8th, the U.S. military deployed new B-1 bombers and thousands of additional troops to the country surrounding Iraq. Weeks earlier, Staff Sergeant Weaver had received the order to deploy.
Don, too short. I'm going to the desert. Nobody cares if your uniform's pressed over there.
There would be no time for long goodbyes. Hours later, Weaver would be on a plane bound for Kuwait.
This happens every time. I don't know why I ever rely on a date or a time.
Hey, kiss. Yes. Night-night.
Staff Sergeant Weaver spent the evening at home with his kids. It was the last time he'd be able to tuck them in or kiss them goodnight for a long while.
I'd be very lonely without you.
The next day, families all around Fort Stewart gathered to say goodbye.
Hey, I give you a call.
Shipping out is never easy, but this time, with war possible, the anxiety was palpable. Even Weaver's youngest, 18-month-old Chase, seemed to sense that something was wrong.
Okay, come here. He knows. I don't know how he does, but he knows.
And Christina wouldn't let go of her dad.
I love you, okay?
I love you too.
You sure?
Yes.
Yeah?
Weeks earlier, Staff Sergeant Weaver had vowed he would not cry, but in the end, even this warrior could not hold back.
Daddy's got a lot of stuff to do, okay? I know. I love you. Okay?
Bye.
I'll talk to you when I get there, all right?
Okay.
I'll drop you a letter. I'll see you when I get home. Okay?
I love you.
I love you.
Today, he is on the ground in Kuwait, for now, just training, and like so many others around the world, waiting to find out if in the months to come, his life will be changed forever by war. Next, we'll hear from the man who will play a key role in deciding if and when that war will begin.
At the count of three, you're going to be a chicken. One.
Is this dangerous?
No, you don't even need that insurance. Two.
What insurance?
If you're sick, you miss work, they pay you cash. Three, you're a chicken. Now, you're a duck.
Aflac. Ask about it at work.
Aflac.
What do you call a sports sedan? That's more sports than sedan.
So.
The all-new 220 horsepower Mazda 6.
Come on, Seesaw. Come play with Daddy.
One, two, and three.
There's a snack that won't weigh you down. Quakes. Go ahead. Snack away.
Who can sign for a package when you're busy signing for lunch? Get a mailbox at Mailbox Etc. and we'll help by receiving your packages when you can. There's help in here. Real help.
Now a new patch from Nicotrol has all the strength you need to help beat cigarettes one craving at a time and help prevent nicotine from disturbing your sleep. And with Nicotrol, you're twice as likely to succeed than with cold turkey. The new Nicotrol Step Down Patch helps beat cigarettes one craving at a time.
Where's Matt?
You forgot, didn't you?
No.
Just call him.
No, he'll think I'm an idiot.
Hello?
Hello to you, too.
Slideshow?
Absolutely right.
You have the cable in your hands, right?
Yes, I do.
All right, we'll put that down.
Right.
Take out the memory stick, pop it right into the front of the TV.
Isn't that just fantastic? You know, thank you so much for calling.
Paris?
Paris.
You're really up on all this technology, huh?
Skip stuff.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Everly Brothers.
NBC Next on an all-new American Dreams.
Go, go, go!
An ultimatum.
Bring these grades up. We won't be dancing on the show.
Beth, I lied to you.
A confession.
You slept with her.
Okay, it was nothing.
Get out!
And a decision a father can never take back.
Plenty of people didn't trust that polio vaccine when it first came out.
Yeah, but this was me. This was my son.
An unforgettable American Dreams. NBC Next.
You may have graduated, but you're not done with school. It's time to hit the books with your kids. Their success depends on you.
Whether the families that we've met tonight will find themselves swept up in a war may hinge on the actions of this man, Secretary of State Colin Powell. He's a key advisor to the president and the leader of America's diplomatic efforts to build an international coalition to disarm Saddam. When I spoke with the secretary 3 days ago, he insisted the president had not made a decision about whether the U.S. would go to war.
Mr. Secretary, is it still possible to have a diplomatic solution to Iraq, no military war, and keep Saddam Hussein in power there?
The president is still trying to see if a diplomatic, peaceful solution can be obtained. But it will require the elimination of the weapons of mass destruction that the Iraqi regime, we believe, still has.
But with 2 weeks to go until weapons inspectors must report to the UN, the inspection team says so far they have not found any smoking gun that proves Saddam has chemical or biological weapons.
Practically speaking, Mr. Secretary, don't you have to have irrefutable evidence of some kind before you can go to war against Saddam Hussein and expect international cooperation?
No, if the international community sees that Saddam Hussein is not cooperating in a way that would allow you to determine the truth of the matter, then he is in violation of the UN Resolution 1441. So you don't really have to have a smoking gun.
Powell says the United States may have other ways to demonstrate that Saddam has violated the UN Resolution.
We will have a presentation to make to the international community as to whether or not we believe Saddam Hussein is cooperating.
Will that be an overwhelming case?
We will see. Overwhelming is in the eyes of the receiver. We think there is a case that will be made and will be persuasive.
If you make that case and the UN Security Council remains divided and the international community remains divided, as the chief foreign policy advisor to the president, would you go to him and say, we believe that we have a sufficient case now to initiate military action against Iraq if we have to do it unilaterally?
The president has always said, and he's made it absolutely clear, that his preferences are in this order. One, a peaceful solution. Two, we would like to see the international community rally and give the authority for all necessary means to be used. But if the international community finds itself unable to do that, then the president has always said, in order to protect the American people and protect our interests in the world, he will take unilateral action to take out Saddam Hussein.
It is perhaps the most difficult decision a leader can make, to send his troops into battle, to risk not only their lives, but those of countless others around the globe. The president may be forced to make just such a decision in the weeks or months ahead. But at what cost to families such as the Weavers, the Kellys, the Namas, and the family of Mohammed El-Rubai? It is too soon to know.
As we have seen tonight, in the lives of the powerful and the ordinary, even the prospect of war is not to be taken lightly. For war takes lives and leaves lasting scars. War can be at once triumphant and tragic. And the test of war is not a military victory alone, but...
At GMC, being professional grade means you do things better. That's why the GMC Sierra has more horsepower than any other pickup in the world. Envoy comes with the most front head and leg room in its class, and Yukon has the tightest turning radius in its class. GMC, we are professional grade. GM owners or lessees can get $3,000 total cash back on all new GMCs. See the pros at your local GMC dealers.
News tonight, six conditions for Saddam Hussein to avoid a war. The British try to work it out at the United Nations. A quarter of a million American troops are in the Persian Gulf now. Is that enough to fight the war and keep the peace? We'll take a closer look. The little girl who vanished in Utah last year, Elizabeth Smart, is found alive. And when the Great Lakes ice over for this long, could it spell economic disaster?
ABC News. This is World News Tonight with Peter Jennings, reporting tonight from Kuwait.
Good evening. We would not normally choose to broadcast from a hotel lobby, but here in Kuwait tonight, there is a huge sandstorm in progress. It is the season, and millions of tons of sand, maybe billions of tons out there, are being driven by gale force winds. It is the desert in your face. It is very tough on the city here, and it is very tough on those American troops who may be getting this one tonight. A little later in the broadcast tonight, the Kuwait experience in this run-up to a war. Many people in this neighborhood believe that war could begin in a matter of days. At the United Nations today, President Bush's strongest ally, Britain, has been working on yet another compromise that may win UN support for military action. The British government, which is facing overwhelming opposition to war at home, proposed setting six new conditions for Iraq to meet and avoid war. And the U.S. says it now has the support of three previously undecided African countries on the Council for a resolution that would essentially pave the way for war. We expect that as soon as the U.N. votes and the President wants a vote this week, Mr. Bush will speak to the nation and deliver the final ultimatum to the Iraqi leader. ABC's Terry Moran is at the White House, as always. Terry, the White House did not openly endorse the British effort of the United Nations. Why not?
Because, Peter, officials say the president is not now willing to sign on to what the British are proposing. This is the first time in the whole process that Mr. Bush is stepping back and letting his beleaguered ally, Tony Blair, take the lead.
The British Prime Minister revealed his latest proposals for a compromise at the UN in Parliament this morning.
What we are looking at is whether we can set out a very clear set of tests for Iraq to meet in order to demonstrate that it is in full compliance.
Under the British plan, Saddam Hussein must make a televised public statement in Arabic admitting he has weapons of mass destruction, allow Iraqi scientists to be interviewed by weapons inspectors outside the country, surrender and account for all stores of anthrax, surrender and account for all production facilities for biological weapons, destroy all prohibited Al-Samud missiles, and account for all unmanned drone aircraft in Iraq. The British Foreign Minister called these conditions reasonable.
Each of these tests is demanding, but eminently deliverable.
The big sticking point between the British and the U.S., the deadline. British sources say Mr. Blair would like to offer Saddam Hussein a week to 10 more days to comply, but U.S. officials say the president is not now willing to budge from the March 17th deadline, despite claims from leaders around the world that he is rushing to war.
Let me put it this way. The president is going the last mile for diplomacy.
If the U.S. does have the support of the three African nations, then the breakdown on the council now looks like this. Seven votes in favor of the current Iraq resolution, two short of the nine needed to pass it. Five opposed, including three, France, Russia, and China, who could veto it, and three, Mexico, Chile, and Pakistan, still undecided.
The White House still insists the president intends to call for a vote by the end of this week at the UN. And should the U.S. lose, the president could address the nation that night and issue his own ultimatum to Saddam Hussein before going to war.
Terry Moran at the White House, many thanks. So even if the British get their way with this new UN resolution, it is far from clear whether Saddam Hussein will even consider the conditions. ABC's Dan Harris is in Baghdad.
Peter, these benchmarks would be a bitter pill for the Iraqis to swallow.
Allowing scientists to leave Iraq for interviews. The Iraqis have long said they don't think such interviews are necessary. But if the Iraqis change their mind, which they've done before under pressure, the UN says they could get the scientists and their families out in a matter of hours. Destroying banned Al-Samud II missiles. The Iraqis have now crushed about half of them. If Iraq picks up the pace, the UN says all roughly 120 could be destroyed before any deadline. Other benchmarks would be much trickier. Settling the anthrax question. The Iraqis insist back in 1991 they took all of their anthrax into the desert and destroyed it. The inspectors say the Iraqis have never actually proved this assertion. In early March, Iraq promised to give the inspectors a report on how to prove it. 10 days later, the report still hasn't materialized. Finally, a public statement by Saddam Hussein admitting he's been hiding weapons of mass destruction. Many believe the Iraqi president would never make such a humiliating concession.
That benchmark may, in the end, prove to be a test Hussein is guaranteed to fail. Peter?
ABC's Dan Harris in Baghdad. Former President Clinton said today that he thinks Iraq can be disarmed without a war. He said that the British plan for a UN resolution is a good one. It is hard to overestimate how much difficulty the British Prime Minister is in at the moment because he has so closely aligned himself with President Bush on this question of war. The British, like millions of other Europeans, think this is a preemptive war by the United States and not the way to solve the Saddam Hussein problem. ABC's Richard Gisbert reports tonight from London.
Tony Blair went to Parliament today wanting to talk about his six new conditions for Saddam, but instead found himself under fire.
We do need another UN resolution, and there is no need for an unseemly haste to war.
Yeah. If there is no second resolution, the US will go to war without the UK?
Yeah. What is at stake here is not whether the United States goes alone or not. It is whether the international community is prepared to back up the clear instruction that it gave to Saddam Hussein with the necessary action.
Blair is constantly trying to convince doubters of the need for war. Earlier this week, it was a televised town meeting where his own supporters laid into him.
I voted for you as well, twice. I won't again unless you start to make moves in a statesmanlike way, like the French, like the Russian, like Nelson Mandela.
If I think there is a negotiated way through, I'll take it.
The audience was unconvinced and mocked the Prime Minister with slow hand claps.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For Tony Blair, it all comes down to what happens at the United Nations. Polls say 80 to 90% of Britons oppose a war without the UN's backing. But 75% would support Blair if the UN agrees.
America's impatience with the UN and its threats to sidestep the Security Council just turn up the heat on its most important ally.
I wonder whether the President does want to put the Prime Minister in that position.
But that is the position Tony Blair finds himself in, stuck between his ally in Washington, who is willing to go without the UN, and voters here who say no. Richard Gisbert, ABC News, London.
We're going to take a closer look tonight for the sake of argument, because there still is one, as to whether the United States has enough troops in this region to do what President Bush says he wants to do. One, get rid of Saddam Hussein and change the regime. Two, control Iraq until it can begin to democratize itself. And three, this is what commanders worry about, protect the U.S. rear in the process. Proposition, that every time the U.S. engages the Iraqis on the battlefield, the U.S. will win.
How much pressure is that?
There's some pressure there. I would tell you that we want a quick war, too. We want it to be over quickly.
General William Scott Wallace commands the Army's 5th Corps. Commanders also say that if the Iraqis decide to fight in the cities or use chemical weapons, it will take longer for the U.S. to impose its will on the country as a whole. No one knows if everyone with a gun will accept an American victory. Proposition, when the heaviest fighting is over, a sizable American force will be needed to stabilize the nation.
And an awesome responsibility put on the shoulders of some young soldiers.
The U.S. now has 245,000 troops in the region. If the U.S. wins big in a very short time, as the public seems to expect, are there enough troops to stabilize the rear and protect the U.S. supply lines? Commanders who bring up supplies behind the lines tell us they may be at greater risk than combat troops from Iraqis who want to take a shot at the U.S. occupation. General Greg Newbold used to command the 1st Marine Division.
We certainly have enough to defeat the enemy, but the country is very large, very complex, and we don't have many forces that will trail behind the lead units to stabilize the population, to control events.
And what about refugees? Proposition. When the fight begins, many Iraqis may panic and run. If only 10% of the population in the southern city of Basra flees, that's 150,000 refugees crowding the roads. Multiply that fear throughout the country on thousands of miles of road which the U.S. needs. And what about prisoners of war? Proposition. Thousands and thousands of Iraqis are expected to surrender. Remember the Gulf War? The U.S. was overwhelmed by surrendering Iraqis and did not have the troops to handle them, and may not now.
We're going to take a substantial number of prisoners, and that we will have to confront a large population of displaced personnel or refugees, and at the same time we have to fight the Iraqi army, then we need a lot of force to do that, and underestimating that could be a big mistake.
So does any of this put U.S. forces in real danger? In combat, not likely. Behind the lines, when the first fighting is over, yes, say commanders, and handling refugees and prisoners of war, it will be an exhausting distraction. When this war was first considered and the military said it needed 250,000 troops to do the job, some of the civilian leaders in Washington ridiculed the plan. Now the Pentagon thinks it may need 100,000 men more for several years. And one other development overseas today, murder in Belgrade. In Belgrade, the prime minister who led the revolt to overthrow the dictator Slobodan Milosevic was killed by snipers. Not clear what the motive was, but Prime Minister Zoran Djindjic had recently taken a very hard line against organized crime. And there is no more dangerous enemy in the Balkans. We'll have a final report from Kuwait City a little later in the broadcast, but there is, as always, still other news in the world. And for that, we go to ABC's Charlie Gibson, who's in New York. Charlie?
Peter, there is indeed other news, and it is extraordinary news. Still ahead on World News Tonight, Elizabeth Smart, the Utah teenager, kidnapped from her bedroom 9 months ago, is found, and she is alive. Also, coming up, why a big chill across the Great Lakes may cause big losses.
World News Tonight with Peter Jennings and MoneyScope.com. Brought to you by H&R Block.
Every year, Americans overpay nearly $1 billion in taxes. Let H&R Block help get your money back. We'll double-check past returns free. Those who refiled with us average $1,300 more.
Hi, grape nuts, please.
You know, it'd take four bowls of grape nuts to equal the B vitamins in just one bowl of Total.
Four bowls.
Dig in, Lumpy.
Special K, please.
That'd take 16 bowls to equal the zinc in Total.
16 bowls. Eat up, sweetie.
Shredded wheat? 40 bowls to equal the calcium in Total.
40 bowls. Chow down, big boy.
You need Total. It's got 100% daily value of 12 vitamins and minerals. No other cereal comes close.
Total, please.
Total for me.
We're out of bowls.
Total, Total Raisin Bran. What are you getting for breakfast?
I've got to get a new car.
I've got to get to my Lincoln Mercury dealer.
Think big at your Lincoln Mercury dealer's Think Big sales event, where you can get big incentives on every Lincoln and Mercury, including Sable, Mountaineer, the new Lincoln Aviator, and Mercury Grand Marquis, with $3,500 cash back. That's $3,000 plus $500 sales event bonus cash for total customer cash back of $3,500. Think big now through March 31st at your Lincoln Mercury dealer.
Realtors help you buy and sell real estate, but helping build communities is what they do best. Like Oral Lee Brown from California. 15 years ago, she made a promise and kept it.
I told them to just stay in school and I would pay their way to college.
Across the country, realtors are making their communities a better place to live. That includes Charlie Ockler, who volunteers as a basketball coach. Realtors adhere to a code of ethics. It's these values that help them live up to an even higher standard.
A relative said it this evening. It is a miracle. Elizabeth Smart, the smiling 15-year-old girl abducted from her home in Salt Lake City 9 months ago, has been found, and she has been found alive. ABC's Judy Muller has been following this story. Judy?
Charlie, this is an amazing development. Elizabeth Smart, now 15 years old, found alive today in the Salt Lake suburb of Sandy. Back in June, you may recall, her sister said Elizabeth was abducted by a man who got into the house by cutting through a screen window. Disguised in a wig, Elizabeth Smart was found in the car of Brian David Mitchell, also known as Emmanuel. He did one day's work at the Smart home, but is known as a drifter and a street preacher. The Smart family released an updated sketch last month based on the memory of Elizabeth's sister, who was in the bedroom the night of the abduction. Acting on a tip, police pulled over Mitchell's car this afternoon. Mitchell was taken into custody, and Elizabeth was taken to a police station for a reunion with her parents and a medical exam. Elizabeth Smart's abduction last June triggered an enormous manhunt and 16,000 tips to police. The top suspect for a while was Richard Reese, a handyman. He died August 30th of a cerebral hemorrhage. Her parents never gave up hope of finding Elizabeth alive.
Elizabeth, we love you. The world loves you. Everybody's praying for you.
And Charlie, that reunion is now happening. Elizabeth is back with her family.
Judy, do we have any sense, because it's been 9 months since Elizabeth was abducted, do we have any sense of where she was during that period of time?
We have confirmed that Elizabeth spent some of that time out of the state and has just recently returned to Utah.
And the other question is, how much of a miracle is this when a child is kidnapped and disappears for a long period of time? Is there any sense of how common it is that she might be found alive?
Certainly the odds were really against this reunion ever happening. Less than 2% of all disappearance cases are resolved with finding the abducted child or person alive.
Charlie? But in this case then, the 1 in 50 shot, Elizabeth Smart found alive, and this man arrested along with a third person that was with them at the time, another woman also arrested by police in the Salt Lake City area. When we return, will a deep freeze over the Great Lakes put the shipping season on ice?
See it build. See it transform. If you have an idea, a plan, a dream, see it with CIT.
I'm Keith Hernandez.
And I'm Walt Clyde Frazier.
What a marvelous night for the action.
Let's go to the play-by-play.
Oh, there's Mr. Greybeard approaching Miss Hottie. Oh, no.
Rejected.
Clyde, that's gotta hurt.
Yeah, no play for Mr. Grey. Get that man our Just for Men Brush In Color Gel.
It's specially formulated to penetrate coarse facial hair and gets rid of gray in 5 easy minutes.
Gets rid of strikeouts, too. Just for Men Gel.
The Rejuvenator.
There's a lot of people out there with a lot of need. Walmart gives us the opportunity to help more people than we'd ever be able to help on our own. They're our friends and our neighbors. Every Walmart down the street and across the country is helping their communities through the Good Works program. With education, the environment, the children always have a special place in my heart. Their eyes tell their whole story, and their faces and their smiles. You just get emotional. I think it brings a tear to your eye to see the difference that you can make. The giving part is what makes you happy.
I got hair on here, and if I look, I also highlight it hurts. Oh, hi. I have my light.
With Crest White Strips, the strip stays for 30 minutes, so it whitens 5 times better.
Now we're talking.
Crest White Strips, the secret to a whiter smile is in the strip.
Looks like heartburn.
Showtime!
Wait, look! They don't just have heartburn.
They also have pressure and bloating. That's gas.
Oh, no!
Sorry, guys. They need more than just heartburn relief. They need Maine.
Hey, Maalox Max.
When you have it all,
treat it all.
You bet. Fast heartburn relief plus strong gas relief. That's Maalox Max.
Thanks, Max.
Just doing my job. Maalox Max. When you have it all, treat it all.
Who does your taxes? Are they done right? Brad Saylor, Chris Nelson, and Michael Yim took the free H&R Block Double Check Challenge and got more back, an average of $1,300. See if we can find you more.
Tomorrow, only Peter Jennings face-to-face with Tommy Franks, the general who will lead troops to war. An ABC News exclusive tomorrow on World News Tonight.
This has been, as everyone knows, a brutally cold winter. How cold? Well, three of the Great Lakes, Huron, Superior, Erie, have the thickest ice pack in decades. As ABC's Dean Reynolds reports, the ice is freezing the economics of an entire region.
The ice is so thick on Lake Superior now that it took this Coast Guard cutter 3 hours today to go 500 yards. From Duluth all the way to Montreal, vital navigation channels remain impassable as vast stretches of the Great Lakes have frozen over. With tugboats moored and barges idle, the St. Lawrence Seaway connecting the lakes to the Atlantic has been forced to delay opening for a week.
If it's longer than that, you start to get into some more major disruptions right down the supply chain.
Already, workers are being laid off and companies are turning to more expensive means of shipment. Evidence of the deep freeze can be found as far south as Chicago's Lake Michigan shoreline. That's the Coast Guard cutter Mobile Bay in the middle of a sea of white.
Steady on 004, checking 003.
In a normal winter, this ship would be breaking ice off Green Bay, Wisconsin.
But it's been so cold for so long this winter that it's now needed in Chicago area ports. The first time that's been the case in a quarter century. But we could walk out on this?
Most definitely.
Really? Yes. I'll take your word for it.
Together with a Coast Guard helicopter spotter, the Mobile Bay is trying to open the way for tugs and barges in the port of Indiana.
For the last 2 weeks, they've been unable to move any barges between those ports.
For those dependent on shipping, the icebreaker's arrival was cause for celebration.
Thank you so much, and your crew.
Holly Headland runs a fleet of tugboats.
We're losing $30,000 to $50,000 a week, every week that we're not moving steel.
Right 10 degrees, rudder.
So it is nice to see the icebreaker here, but if it doesn't visit again for another 25 years, no one will complain. Dean Reynolds, ABC News on Lake Michigan.
And for more on the weather's impact on the national economy, you can go to moneyscope.com. When we come back, why would the price of real estate go up in a war zone? Peter Jennings will have a report.
Don't we need broccoli? I think I need a haircut.
Kids who can't wait to go on everyday errands?
How are we on gas?
Here's why. Bank One introduces Disney's Visa credit card. The new way to turn your everyday spending into magical Disney rewards. Disney's new Visa card.
You don't know what I had to do to get here.
Only from Bank One.
Only new Oust air sanitizer kills odor-causing bacteria in the air.
I mostly sprayed Lysol in the air. I thought Lysol was an air sanitizer.
It's true. Lysol works on surfaces, but it's not meant for the air. Only Oust air sanitizer kills 99.9% of odor-causing bacteria in the air.
My daughter Carly is like a tomboy, and her clothes are stinky and gross. Little spray right away. It smells great. Just fresh.
Get odor-causing bacteria out with new Oust air sanitizer. S.C. Johnson, a family company.
Oust gets rid of the odors, doesn't mask the odors.
I hate it when he does that.
Sorry about the dust.
Come on, guys, let's go.
The powerful new Chevy Trailblazer EXT. Room for seven. Room for everything.
I love the bagels in the jet.
Chevy Trailblazer, like a rock.
In the future, everyone's glasses will automatically adjust to changing light and block out harmful UV rays that can damage the eyes. But for those with transitions lenses, the future is already here. Ask your eye care professional, because the danger is real now, and so is the protection. Transitions, right in any light.
And now by the authority vested.
So young, naive. I bet they don't have a clue.
Or that insurance.
What insurance? The one that pays you cash if you're sick and can't work. What was that?
The name is...
Aflac. Ask about it at work.
Parents, talk to your kids about sex, even if one of you has to...